It's kind of amazing, but I'm dedicating this podcast to you, citizen journalists out there risking your lives. And I just want to tell you a little bit about the gang stalking that you're encountering and will encounter, especially in the next in the next few months. I'm always ahead here, you know, in time. So you can check you can check to see what's going to happen. But this is what's going to happen. They find out who you are. They find out where you live. They triangulate around your neighbors and your friends and people that are sympathetic to their side. Remember, these are the criminals, okay? The goats and the sheep. You're a sheep. They're criminal goats. I don't want to insult goats, but I mean, obviously, that's what's the divide is. And they, you know, they operate. You see how they are with the election. Jill Stein's one of them, and working for Soros, and how they rig the elections, and they rig this, and they rig war, they overthrow countries, they put people in bondage, they kill, you know, tens and hundreds and millions of people over time. So I just call them the totalitarians, you know, because I just feel that really kind of, you know, there's no sense calling them Democrats or left or anything. They're just the totalitarian, the authoritarian, totalitarian, technocrats, whatever. And kleptocrats, you know, right? But they get it by stealing. Okay, so, you know, so what comes next is you're going to be gang stalked, okay? And a lot of you don't even know what that is. Some of you are 22 years old or 24 years old or whatever you are. You're just, you know, you're like around, you're younger than my daughter. My daughter, when she was 21, knew stuff because she tuned into me. You know, she at first was told I was terrible and I'm a mental case and everything else. Then she started listening and then she goes, Dad, you're not all those things that all they said about you. And it's so awful, but I've gone through the same treatment in my own way that, you know, you see people getting in the public eye in their way. And certainly Trump is taking the brunt of everything. But I mean, you know, to a lesser extent, I suppose, we've all had all that. When you're a kid, it's very traumatizing to have them suddenly realize, oh my God, I'm a sheep, I'm not a goat. And then they all jump, you know? So, okay. So here's what they do. All right. You know, weird things happen. Okay, there's the subtle things. That is, if it gets more extreme, there's a couple of you, they find out who the leaders are, okay? That's number one. So now they know who the leaders are, how it's shaken out. And you know who you are out there, okay? So then they, you know, they'll triangulate around with your friends, associates, whoever can be turned into their stead, neighbors, you know, to create a kind of a spy network and put you under a kind of a surveillance, okay? That's numero uno, and that's very easy for them because they've, you know, they're well-trained in that sort of thing. And then, you know, there's also the electronics. Yes, they do beam people with ELF frequencies, and they're able to target you, you know, you specifically, where you go in your car, whatever you do, it's just, it's a lock-on. And I don't think I'm saying anything that people in this sort of TI community, they know all about all this, you know, and they have no, just imagine whenever they go for grievance and whenever they go for redress, they're told they're crazy or wind up in a mental hospital. So they can't, so they're shamed into not talking about it, yet they keep doing it to them. Now, they also do electronic experimentation on people, on mass populations, with satellite weaponry. Now, that's something that Dr. John Hall is expert in that, and I'm not going to go into too much of the technical on that, but, you know, it's a struggle, right? Because they can use microwaves to, you know, just to irradiate you, basically. And you're just, you know, to cook you, if you will, without you being able to do anything about it. It's a terrible, sadistic thing, but a lot of you are going to find out about this now. And so, you know, it can go to all kinds of extremes, and then you'll be told along the way that if you want it to be turned down, if you want it to go away, you'll play ball, and they'll see if they can turn any of you. Okay? Turning any of you means, just as it says, if they can turn you to be a spy, a double agent or whatever, then they'll turn that crap off. But it's really hard because, you know, they, you know, it's hard on people's health. And people do die early, you know, in the service of truth because they're getting hit with weaponry that your average citizen is not getting hit with. And so, therefore, their life expectancy would be going down And that's one of the sad, tragic things about gang stalking. We call it gang stalking. It's really electronic harassment. It's really harassment, okay? It's really a targeted harassment, if you will, that can easily be done. And right now, the Pizzagate researchers are right in the crosshairs of the gang stalkers, and it just, it's a, you know, it's a match and gasoline that's right there, okay? So it's, I have to get out of ahead of this and be, you know, a, so that if anyone listens to this, I suppose, that is involved, that maybe you'll have a heads up about this stuff. And so when it starts happening, you won't be like, because what they want to do is marginalize you like you're crazy, right? Get you into treatment. You know, you're going to seek help. You don't want to go to the, you know, AMA or anything, because once they can get a record on you of seeking out even a therapist, even a psychologist, that, you know, becomes a strike against you and can be used to discredit, which is the whole goal at this point, is to discredit you. And also the other forms of harassment are okay as follows, you know, so listen up. One, they break into your house, you know, they have ways of getting keys and things to make it look like, you know, I mean, it's, they break in without breaking anything, if you will. And they set up surveillance, sometimes cameras, recorders, little tiny devices you're not going to find. They bug your house. And then the other form of harassment with your home and your dwelling and your car is, you know, doing little things to it. In other words, doing little things that, you know, would make you paranoid. Like, has someone been in here? Has someone been here? You know, has... was that really moved over? That looks like it was moved over there. I didn't move it over there. That plant was over there. You know what I mean? Things like that. And that's a program that they start in, and then they just kind of start ramping that up to where you think you're going crazy. You're not going crazy. You're being harassed. Okay? But they, and then you have the friends suddenly turning on you because someone has whispered in their ear some really nasty things about you. And so suddenly your neighbors are all looking at you, looking down at you with hatred because you're, oh, you're kidding. Oh, God, well, we'll keep an eye on him. Okay, well, here's a camera, and you can, you know, just keep it beamed on the house, please. Oh, no problem. Yeah, this kind of guy. Yeah, we don't want that in our neighborhood. And so that's the other form it takes. And they can hit you with all of it at once, you know. You remember how it was with Enemy of the State with Will Smith, the movie. Well, now it's about 100 billion times more sophisticated than that. So, you know, and then, of course, it goes to your place of employment. People there at your place of employment, then, you know, this is where it starts getting kind of frightening. You know, and you're not feeling well. You're being beamed. You're being, you know, hurt. You're being, you know, it can be poisoning in a restaurant. You can't, you know, with restaurants. Good advice would be don't go to the same restaurant over and over again because they find out where you go and then they, you know, there's a lot of people. It may not be the chef, but it's the assistant or somebody that's one of them. You know, it's like a big club, a big network of people. And they're all connected, you know, worldwide. And they coordinate these attacks. You could also say these are spiritual attacks. I mean, I've always called them spiritual, you know, spiritual warfare because, you know, I told you yesterday, you know, it's the Safeway Market. It's over at the restaurant there. It's over here. How can they coordinate all these places just at random out in Los Angeles, you know, and all be kind of connected and just sort of following a stream? They can. I mean, I don't know how. I really don't. Or how can you fly to Hawaii and they're sitting there waiting for you? I don't know. It's so bizarre. But that starts getting tinging into the supernatural, which you probably don't want to hear about right now, but that it can get really exotic. You know, it can get really beyond Jason Bourne, you know, very quickly. What's the motivation? It's because they're going to turn that. They don't care how much money they're going to, it's, you know, it's a money thing too. You have to put money into this, pay these people, and they do stuff, right? Besides that, putting you on 24/7, monitors, just like you see in the, you know, when you see the Jason Bourne, you see wherever Bourne goes, you know, they have them on video of everything, right? They can coordinate that if it's a high enough level target. That's usually reserved for spies and, you know, big, you know, the big war that's going on, the big covert war. But, you know, at this point, the Pizzagate researcher is just as big a threat as Jason Bourne would be, you know? So it's, you might get the royal treatment, which is just unbelievable. And they can get more weird. I mean, they can just shoot you as well. So you've got all that. They already spent money paying that actor to go into Comet Ping Pong with his gun, which we talked about yesterday. But, you know, were you aware that the news story was published on Google hours before the story ever broke or before it even happened? So that was a scripted, coordinated false flag to shame the Pizzagate researcher. They're coming after the Pizzagate researcher. Look, the Pizzagate issue, the researchers who are unhinged and crazy. And if you think you could watch Fox News, you can't. Greg Gutfeld is a huge enemy of yours. He is, you know, one of the people that's trying to create an atmosphere where you become a pariah, where then they could take a legal action against you or even a physical harm action against you and be justified. And that's because Greg Gutfeld is one of them, and he doesn't care about kids. He obviously doesn't care about, I believe he knows exactly what's going on, but he's another shill for them. So it's, if you think it's a benign thing, watch it. Why did he sell out? Because he wants money, obviously. So for people that are fans of his, thinking he's a nice conservative voice out there, think again. This is a monster. You know, this is just a wolf in sheep's clothing is what it is. And the same thing with Jake Tapper and a lot of other people that are really showing their true colors right now. And they're demanding, with no proof, with no evidence whatsoever, without addressing any of the, you know, the emails or anything else, any of the circumstantial evidence, it's a hoax, there's nothing to see here, go away, shut up, or we will shame you. Well, it doesn't matter now, does it? Because the MSM is at this stage, this story, the election did them in bad. They were done after the election, but this is the final death blow to the MSM. They may have their very small group of people who watch them, who are ideologically connected, but in general, I think the public is basically going to switch them off permanently at this point, and it's going to be over Pizzagate, and that's how. And why are they doing this to themselves? Because it's the biggest issue of the time. Now, they're already starting in with the disinfo, which they always do. Number one, satanic panic. Okay, we've had this. Geraldo was involved in covering it up at one point. And various people, they're going to go out and look for pedophiles. They can't find any. Where are they? They're just a few over here, a few over there. There's 100 kids we freed. The human trafficking is real. I mean, they're almost getting to the point of saying that the human trafficking that Govin and I talk about every 20th to end human trafficking and human slavery by 2020, I guess we're a hoax too. But since we started praying together and having this 2020, that's Govinda's initiative, it seems that we've gotten some results. Maybe some we didn't count on, but I'd still consider this all God's will and God's moving. You know, the light is hitting this stuff, and they don't know what to do. They think because they're stupid. Okay, one thing you got to understand about the MSM, they are stupid. Okay, they don't believe in God, so they're stupid. So they think that if they shame they don't think it's like something like karma or like the Lord's will or like the Lord's judgment, which it is. They think that if they shame the Pizzagate researcher, he's the problem. Look, a guy with an AR-15 went in there, and I called it a shotgun yesterday, but now it's an AR-15, and he shot it in the restaurant. I mean, that's bad enough. Look what these people have done to these innocent people in Washington, D.C. in a regular restaurant that's never done one wrong thing. I mean, it's outrageous. It's horrible. It's just horrible what they've done. I really think that there should be a law against these people. These are the same conspiracy theorists. Listen to Alex Jones. And that's just terrible. And even though Alex is the one out there poo-pooing it and saying, wait, it's a distraction from the bigger crimes going on. No, it isn't a distraction. He's wrong in that regard. But he's just trying to not be, I know what he's doing. He's trying to keep it there, but not, you know, go too far with it, because it's all circumstantial, of course. We all know that. Nothing is actionable, not to slime people or ruin their careers or accuse them of anything. You know, they're innocent until proven guilty. He's trying to give them, he's trying to do the right thing, okay? I mean, but what I mean by wrong is, it's not a distraction looking, you know, not seeing the other crimes. It leads to the other crimes. It's just that it's a hot potato and he doesn't want to have that front and center right now, because so he's out there with stories like this. Pizzagate is a distraction. You know, it's not actionable, that we can't do anything until there's more evidence. But look at these other crimes. So now he's trending on YouTube, which he never is, trending on YouTube. But he's trying to keep it in balance with the other things. And that's also good advice. Yes, there are many other things going on. But I thought, you know, in my small kiosk here, just giving some advice about all this stuff. So this gang stalking, if you will, electronic harassment, if you will, you know, a kind of a police state, you know, because right underneath the surface here, we do have that sort of police state, right? We have a military-industrial complex, right? And we're taught that it's not really there. There's also harassment from these towers that are meant to look like cell phone towers. They look like trees and things. They can, you know, you could be driving by there and they can just, they know you're there. They just, it hits you, you know? Here's some of the symptoms from ELF, okay? A feeling of anxiety in the pit of your stomach. A sinking feeling. A feeling like something is wrong. A feeling like could trigger a fight or flight reaction. Panic attacks. A general feeling of discomfort and or, you know, anxiety and depression. A feeling of... also, there's, you know, there's, they're able to beam, you know, words and different things that will depress you, or that you'll feel hopeless, or you feel what's the use, or you just can't go on, you know, and, or you have thoughts and feelings of suicide, you know, all of this, you know, with everything else in the, in your life, you know, all the people you deal with, the doctors you see, the employment you are involved in, the neighbors in your neighborhood, old friends, a bar, the haunts you hang out in, the coffee, the internet cafe shop, the bakery, you know, all of that can be put into use easily to surveil and, of course, you know, track and then, you know, harass. With a clear message that, you know, it could also go to your animals, you know, like you find your cat dead on the doorstep. And that's a fairly severe warning. What that means is you're next if you don't knock it off. Okay, so that's, you're about to see the, you know, the same people that shut down Assange and shut down, you know, all, they just locked it all up, okay? So there's no actionable evidence. They clipped it. Dead man switches did not. Did not, we're not successful. It's about time you accept that. So there's no help coming from Assange, okay? Whatever this Julian Assange thing is, it's all bogus because he was on this story. And I hear that Julian Assange is calling Trump supporters white trash. That's not something he would say. They got his voice print and they're, you know, how, you know what I mean? Once you get their voice print, they can have you or me or anybody say anything they want. And they say it's Assange. It's not Assange. It's some voice thing. Cause he's saying things he would never say. So, or he's alive and they voice print him. It doesn't matter whether he's alive or dead, he's neutralized. And I'll keep saying that till I'm blue in the face. I mean, until somebody finally, we have to not be so stupid here. We have to use a little bit of logic. You know, it's, you know, the emails, the evidence, the HRC emails and some of the pictures, video and all that on Wiener's computer, it all got locked up. They may be worried that there's evidence, but the evidence in D.C., it's all been cleaned up. It's all made to look squeaky clean. Now, they've had plenty of time to clean every loose end, including in the background, probably killing people that know something that could be a threat and just, you know, but you don't read about that in the paper, do you? No. Or in the internet? No. So you understand this is big, big stuff. This is a big war. It's a big, big, big war. This is as big as World War II, III, IV, V, all combined. You know, so I wish Breitbart would have just surreptitiously dropped what he had on the net, you know, in his own way or through a surrogate or whatever, and been smart. But he wasn't smart, and he paid for it with his life. You saw the way they could do away with him. It made it look like nothing to see here. Then, just for good measure, the coroner got whacked. Oh, he died of mysterious circumstances, a mysterious illness or whatever. But, you know, you get the picture. You know, it's just, it's worse than what you see in the movies. So, you know, I'm just putting out the fair warning to, so you, what I don't want to see is this, okay? And this is, you know, I'm not a sleuth. I can't concentrate on little bits of text and things. That's not my thing. I don't do investigative research. This is to encourage the investigative researcher to, when the blowback happens, so you don't panic. Okay? You've got to have a really strong faith in Jesus Christ, the Lord. If you don't have one now, you will learn, believe me, because your life depends on it at this point. You know, you're going to need supernatural help to get through this thing because it's an ironclad gauntlet of, you know, with that's as impenetrable as possible. You go through that gauntlet and come out as Swiss cheese, okay? And so if you choose to keep going with this Pizzagate thing, you will be made into Swiss cheese. Or they'll take a good stab at it. Now, we do have the Lord on our side here because this is the Lord. It wouldn't even be at this point. They're now saying, because they're stupid, okay, satanic panic, which is something that worked before. Again, what worked before will not work now. But they're going to go ahead and do that. Satanic panic, and then they go, oh, you see, every once in a while, this satanic panic flares up. Everybody suddenly got satanic ritual abuse issues. They're really screen memories. Then they go ahead and shame anybody who's ever been a survivor came forward. That's next. And, you know, they were just mistaken. Let me explain something, folks. And for you people that don't know, this stuff is real, okay? They do harm little kids. There's a huge trafficking thing. That's what we're all talking about. We understand that. That's why we have Human 20 on 20. There's a huge covert slave trade globally involving more people than ever in the past in terms of slavery, whether it's labor slaves, sex slaves, or child slaves. Okay, all that is being trafficked. And if you look at the statistics of missing children, just that, we have one statistic from last year, which is 8 million per year. That's not, you know, so when Comey you frees 82 children, but there's 8 million, it's kind of a, you know, it's a bit lopsided. And I think those statistics come from the same government resource. So it's real, okay? The satanic panic, they always make it like, oh, yeah, everyone's a Satanist. I see, uh-huh. It always disappears. They always make it disappear. They always make it disappear because, oh, come on, not every, the teacher, the guy down the hall, come on, you're paranoid, you need some help. See, and then it goes away because they shame the public and then everyone says, oh, there's nothing to see here. And then the Satanists continue on feeding upon the living. No, a true Satanist, I mean, you know, the dead, I'm sorry. We don't need to call them Satanists. We just call them the dead. Prey upon, you know, because it's everywhere, it's everything, it's all the time, it's the main thing going on here, it disappears, see? Because this is, I mean, we're the Truman, nothing like that could happen, could it, Truman? Oh, no. This is our reality. There's not that reality. And admittedly, that reality does come from offstage. It's not in the news. It's not, it's hidden on your streets. It's hidden everywhere you go. It seems like it's normal. How, you just were mistaken, that's all. You just got into this paranoid thing and started thinking everyone's a Satanist, or rather, everyone's a satanic child murderer. Oh, right. You know, in a pizza place. Uh-huh. Got it. You're nuts, man. You need some help. And we're here to help you. It kind of reminds me of Quaid on Total Recall. Just take the pill and you'll wake up in your bed. You remember, this is your adventure. You paid for it. You're really back at recall. Something's gone wrong. We need you to take the pill so that everything will be all right. This is all fantasy here. This is all part of your dream that you purchased. This is not real, Quaid. Or whatever his name is. Take the pill. And all this goes away. I mean, you know, do you think you're going to go from a lowly construction worker to suddenly this super agent that's going to free the people of Mars? Come on, Quaid, take the pill. and everything will be fine. You know, you're just prone to fantasy here. And of course, he refuses the pill. He shoots the guy in the head. Turns out he's right, and they were trying to trick him, you see. There really is a conspiracy. There really is all this stuff. There really is a pizza game. There really is. It really does exist, all this. There really are lots and lots of Satanists. It really is a battle between, you know, the sons of God and the sons of Belial. It really is the ancient battle. It really is going on everywhere all the time on earth, every single place, every corner of the globe. It's going on. And then, but once it's seen, it can't be seen. It must be concealed. They conceal it so that you go, oh, I was supposed to, there's nothing to see here. And back to business as usual. You know, you go, sorry, you guys. I just suddenly saw all of you as, you know, evil. And you're my friends. I'm sorry. You talk about a mind F. A cluster F. Oh, you got no idea. You got no idea how messed up it can get. Oh, boy. Yeah. You see what happens? It's just like in the game with the David Fincher movie, Michael Douglas and Sean Penn. It's only, you know, they had a central place where they coordinated everything, but it's just how his life just suddenly started, you know, it was all about gang stalking and all about being targeted and what ends up happening, you know, it could get extremely extreme. But you just have to keep your eye on the ball, researchers, because this is, if it isn't happening now, it will be happening. So here's what you got to do. Keep your wits about you, stay in prayer, keep steady with the Lord, with everything you do. Be in prayer and supplication to the Lord, day in and day out. I mean, you should always, all of you should be, and me too. We should all be. But sometimes we get distracted, you know, and then we finally got to get wrenched back. You know, that's why. But anyway, I foresee this, and so I'm just out here warning, you know, like I do, and I, you know, that's just that's my role to play here, and I'm warning about this because this is, you know. This is next. When their false flag didn't work yesterday, and also that could be a test run, they would love to have the guy go shoot the place up, right? Kill a bunch of people, maybe kill some kids, blame it all on the alt-right, and then, you know, put the kibosh down. But the reason they can't right now, is because Trump won the election. So they're doing everything they can to cheat and steal, which is all they do, cheat, steal, destroy. Is it hard for you to see? You see who the political players are now, right? Not Republicans, Democrats, right? It's Satanists and God-fearing people, isn't it? It's one or the other. There's a group that wants Trump out, and they're basically willing to cheat, lie, steal, turn the electors. You know, there's one elector who said yesterday he's getting 4,000 death threats and hate mails a day unless he agrees to tell them he's going to vote, you know, against Trump. It's on. The entire state of California is now legislating against Trump and putting out, and he's not even in office yet. I mean, that's how terrified they are, because they know a lot of them go to jail. Because Trump is the threat to Pizzagate and all that. They see him as a threat to their criminality, which is also money laundering, wars, you know, all this stuff. Soros and all those people are total criminals. I mean, there's just no question about that. And if you want to just go back to war crimes, when he was an SS officer as a young man, you know, with the Nazis, said it was the most happy time of his life. He is nothing if not a total deceiver. And, you know, this idea of spending money on riots and busing people in and then, you know, threatening the electors and turning the electors and buying this. It's all evil stuff. It makes House of Cards with Kevin Spacey on that series look like, you know, some sort of fantasy island show or something, you know, some kind of a light comedy compared to what really goes on and how many people really end up dead and how many people really are above the law and how this stuff, you know, the same people involved in contraband, human trafficking, all that. Yes, are Satanists involved in satanic ritual abuse, but satanic ritual murders and all that stuff. I mean, it's always good. How the murder got separated from pedophilia, I don't know. Because the milk carton kids don't come home. How did they do that? You know, what do they do with the kids after they abuse them? Well, if they're grooming you to be one of the, if you're a son or daughter of somebody that's in the system, in the club, then they're not going to kill you unless you resist. They're just going to groom you to be, you know, a mover and shaker in this world, which means you've got to be a Satanist. I don't think so. But see, that's what happens when civilizations collapse. More and more people go to that side of things, and eventually it's like a big tick. You know, it fills up with people that go on to the wrong side, which is, by the way, folks, when you go over there, you cross the River Styx, you're the dead. I don't know why no one's teaching this in Sunday school or in religious teaching. I don't know. But it's a very real thing that happens to them. Now, you look the same once you've gone over. You look the same. You can talk pretty much the same. But it's light years away from the world that you lived in before. And the things that happen to you and all the things that are change immediately. So there's a discernible, detectable change with anyone that crosses that line. You know, they pay you to cross that line, basically. And, you know, it could be in, you know, your, you know, in beauty. It could be in, you know, whatever your endeavor is, I guess, is enhanced or, you know, potentiated. And that's, they have the power to turn a switch. And that's, so now the wind's been at your front. You've been struggling. Suddenly the wind's at your back. And, you know, you're winning every time. You know, who doesn't want that, right? Well, that's why there's so many people there. And then when there's so many people there, they fall for it. What happens is this civilization collapses. Now, this has happened over and over and over and over and over again. I don't know how many ways I can make the case. If enough people go there, you don't have a civilization. You have bedlam, panic, murder, death, a disease, horror, horror, horror. You see how horrific it is now? That's what happens. Well, see, this isn't like there's a big punchback. This is like the patient is on life support about to die. That's where we are at here in America. And we're almost in a death rattle, and we're struggling to fight back. You know, we're not a lot of us, but we're asking God to help us, you know, just please. Because it's that serious. The patient's about to die. And the forces of death, that those who are you know, opposition, they're doing everything they can and, you know, turning electors and, you know, cheating, lying, stealing, turning judges in Michigan, you know, doing all this stuff to try to prevent what they consider to be death, which is really life. You know, they're trying to prevent, you know, failure, which is really, for us, would be success, right? If you were able to have a country and were able to have the people working and you know, stabilized rather than falling and falling and falling while they're all telling you how great things are. I mean, you know, that geopolitical aspect is, you know, the populations aspect is just one aspect. But, I mean, it's, you know, the central focus for these people is, you know, the body politic and the people. That's the focus of them because they're in the commodity business. The commodity are humans. And that's what the Soros is and all that. That's what they're peddling. But what they forget, and here's the thing, you can't be a Satanist, really, unless you believe in God. The only people that really excel in the satanic civilization, it's really another dimension, the people that excel there, all of them have one thing in common. They all were very, very, you know, were God-believing. They know God exists. They know the whole thing. They are aligning themselves with Satan. They are rebelling, okay? And so that's it, but they know that's where the power comes from, and they usurp the power by doing the opposite, that which is against God. But then they sheen it over to make it look to the public like they're not doing that they're doing. So that's why they rule by deception, and they're able to get into positions like the head of CPS, the head of the EPA, president of the United States. They infiltrate, take over, and then while they're killing you and hurting you, they're posting statistics of how great everything is. Okay, you got it? Because the biggest thing that threatens them, at least on a geopolitical level, would be the success of people in America, you know, or Europe or anywhere else. But the success of the people is what they're deathly afraid of, because they feel that's the end of them, you see. Your success is the death of them. Reminds me of the old Rolling Stones song, Soul Survivor. Remember that? Soul Survivor goes, the soul survivor is going to be the death of me, was the main lyric. You know, if they succeed, I'm dead. See, that's exactly how they think about you. They have to punish you and hurt you in order to have the power and be over you. Once that chain is broken, then, oh my God, they're done. Because they're hanging on a thread, and the thread is their parasites. Because once you go over, you give up that which you need. Now you have to usurp it from the living. And once the living are empowered, then you can no longer suck their souls out. And so a lot of you are disturbed because you know you're being fed upon. You're just not sure how it's working. Yes, that's right. You're here and this is nightmare horror land. You just figuring that out? There's nothing. This is the realm of the dead, my friend. How we wound up here, I don't know. It's God's thing. He's doing it. But I just got to go to my source, the light, God, the true light. And that's where I have to just bask in that, because I don't know. I'm just a, you know, like a kid here. I don't know my way around this. You know, without him guiding me, I'd be going right off the cliff. And so would everybody else. Okay, so we have the battle lines have been drawn. What has been exposed here, okay, is very, very clear. What's been exposed here is the people of the light versus the dark, or the people that are dead versus the living. All that is being exposed through the exposing of the criminality to see what side people are on. In other words, when you see people buying the election and doing the rigging of it, it's funny how they always say the rigger is somebody else, but I mean, you see this going on with the Jill Stein, the judge, the election workers, the electors, this whole program is all lying, cheating, and stealing. All these people have one thing in common. They're all in the same club. The judge, Jill Stein, her people, Clinton's people, Soros's people, they're all in the same club. Notice how Soros turned down the riots just for now, because he thinks he's going to get somewhere with this. So he just turned that off. And notice, too, there is no law. If Soros wants to nuke Texas, nothing can stop him. There's no law against Soros nuking anything. That's got to make you think. If things turn, though, if God really brings his justice, which he's going to do, I mean, there's just no doubt in my mind, then you will see him arrested. The crimes that already been racked up by the Clinton Foundation and the Soros people and a lot of them, it's just staggering. And they are deathly afraid if Trump gets in there, a lot of them will go to jail. Trump won't go after them directly because the president doesn't do that. But, the power thing will shift. So they're fighting for their lives now, too. And that's why they're doing so much cheating. The problem is all this is out in the open, right? The problem on the gang stalking is this, too. The power shift is shifting. The power structure is shifting. So that, the harassment may not be permanent. In fact, a lot of you who have been harassed through all this, there might be relief if Trump actually is seated as president. But again, it's just completely uncertain now. If he isn't, you can expect the Pizzagate people are going to have a really hard time. If he is, you've got General Flynn already saying that it should be looked into. So then you have a friend there, and that would indicate, being a military man, that some of that stuff will be turned off. But for now, here's what we have. The public shaming, and then, of course, it's the guys in the shadows coming after you and, you know, trying to turn people. Now, do they have as much power as they had back in, say, at the beginning of the Obama administration? No, they don't. I wouldn't worry about it tremendously. I'm not going to just talk to scare you about what kind of things they can do. But you know, all the Pizzagate researchers sort of become an enemy in the state. Now also look to the conservative side. You have people like Gutfeld and these other people that represent many people, the left and the right, who are going to, you know, shame and come after. You know, he has been you know, mocking and belittling Alex Jones the whole time, and he's been very vocal, you know, signaling to them, I'm on the team with you guys. So he's, you know what he is. Okay, so you understand that's the fight is on. So I'm doing a fair warning. I just got this inkling, you know, overnight. To warn about the gang stalking, because a lot of people that are doing this research or even posting articles, okay? When I say research, I mean it could be looking at stuff that's already been researched. You're proliferating the information out there. All of you are subject, you know, to harassment. Well, me, I look at what I'm doing. You know, so I've been, you know, it's not my first rodeo, but a lot of these people it would be. Because they're coming out of being innocent, you know, they're horrified at what they're seeing, but then they've never seen anything like the shaming going, the coordinated shaming. They're not used to that. They don't understand where that's coming from. After all they were trying to do was follow that looked like a very, you know, the coded emails and all this stuff. It just paints a very grisly, awful, terrible, terrible, awful picture that should, as General Flynn said, and I'm completely in agreement with him and his son. It should be looked into. Now, don't think for a minute that Flynn's, you know, tweet wasn't scripted. Of course it was. It's really the Trump administration signaling that, you know, they're not going to do anything overtly, but, you know, off to the side, you know, there's a nod, you know, if you know what's going on. Okay. So, yeah, there will be people investigating. You know, with a Trump seated as president, you'd have the FBI able to investigate, probably. You'd have the NYPD probably be able to do something. But, I mean, there's other crimes besides, you know, you deal with money laundering, human trafficking, you know, all the satanic crimes. You're dealing with international crimes. You're dealing with theft of taxpayer money. I mean, it goes to the gamut. And, of course, murders. Lots and lots of those. So, you know, that's just the Clinton Foundation. I mean, all that. All the implications of her as Secretary of State, pay to play, funding ISIS, the four guys killed at Benghazi, you know, destabilizing the Middle East, millions killed in Iraq, all this stuff, founding ISIS, funding ISIS, killing all these people, killing Christians, all going to Clinton, Obama, et cetera, Soros, and whoever the whole group is from the State Department. All the, I mean, a lot of these people would be, if they got the goods on them, which is, it's there, it's just a matter of political will to investigate, then a lot of people would be going to jail. A lot of people would be going away forever. A lot of people should probably be executed for treason. I mean, you've got all that on the table. That's why I said it. This is big. This period of time we're in right now, you just can't take it easy. It's this, see, while people are starting to think Christmas and presents and you want to get into the Christmas spirit and you got to go do this, you got to have dinner with friends and family, you know, that's when they do stuff. That's when they pull all this crap, like stealing an election. You know, right out, so you wake up, you know, December 25th and you go, wow, what happened there? You know, now it's in disarray and it's up to the Congress to decide. Then you go to January 6th where the Congress convenes and they're not sure that they want to seat Trump or not. Maybe it should be somebody else or maybe it will be. But even if they seat him, he'd be terribly compromised, where Paul Ryan's already been signaling that something like that might happen, because he's saying, I'm not quite sure about this Trump agenda, which means to me that Trump will be weakened from where he is now to where he steps in. Obviously, Ryan is imagining him being very weakened. So even if the Congress has to decide, whoever the president would be very weakened, and the Speaker of the House, the Congress would really be running things, the president would be diminished completely, which may also be a part of the plan rather than just an outright flip to Hillary. You see, to have him diminished in power, to take power away, which George Soros said, I'm going to take power from him. Well, the way you do that is by breaking every law there is and laughing at the FBI because it can do nothing. Very bad situation. So the jury's out as to who's going to be in power. Is it going to be Soros? Because he's the one that's been in power the last 8 years, right? Either Soros and his puppets, Or is it going to be a new sheriff in town? With a much stronger force. By the way, the force behind Trump and what I foresaw in the equilibrium talks I did and whenever those started. And remember, I said that they want John Wayne to come back. Somebody the other day called Trump John Wayne. I mean, I can't believe it, the accuracy of the things that I was saying. I can't believe it. It was just stunning, frightening almost. So, you know, and I'm always like, you know, back then I was like, really? Doesn't make sense. You know, I don't believe my own words. So I can never pound the table because I'm like, huh? I start questioning myself. And, you know, but the record is clear. There's a podcast record, so it's clear. Not that everything turns out, you know, I mean, like I didn't know anything about Brexit. I couldn't tell you. I couldn't tell you who's going to win. I can't tell you who's going to be seated on January 20th. So it's weird how it comes and goes. It's almost like I have my part to play, just like you have your part out there. You know, you provide a piece of the puzzle too. So we just got to look at the, you know, I know that Brother Mitch there, he was, when we had him on, and I got to talk to you again. I got to talk to a lot of people. I've been I've been in an embattled, friends. I've haven't been able to plan things and do things, and I feel like my duty has been here to kind of help to keep us from going insane, to keep us from, you know, just being so upset and tired and sad that our lives just end. You know, I'm just trying to, you know, make sure that we understand that as hairy as this thing looks right now, which is really, really hairy, okay? It's like, whoa. These people mean business. The Satanists mean, they're the Satanists. Soros represents the Satanists. Yes. And Trump represents the, you know, like the good guys. And I'm not saying they're all in the clear either. Don't start thinking that. I'm not saying, yeah, Trump can do no wrong. They all want to shame you with that stuff. No, no, no. He's, you know, but there's something going on there with an anointing, okay? Does it carry through forever? Does the God does he pull it away? You know, is it too up to a certain point? We just don't know. I mean, someone may know, have a prophetic inkling, but I mean, you have to have, that's the only way you could know. You know, so, but what I can say is that the, you know, I was led to say, middle of the night type of leading, that comes from, you know, pretty reliable. It's not from my own head, that the gang, the researchers need to be ready for that sort of thing. And it's not going to be all the researchers, you know, I've mentioned that, you know, anyone who posts anything is a researcher, but it's really going to be the leaders. Okay. They've already identified who the leaders are. And so we need to keep them in prayer. That's all. I pray right now in Jesus' name for their total protection and their complete total awareness of all this that's going on. And they're being able to adjust because of you, Lord, because you watch over them in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. I just need you to join me in that so we understand these researchers, the leaders out there. And you know who they are. They make the videotapes. They do the research. They were on 4chan, Reddit. They got banned off Reddit. I think they're banned on 4chan. I think they go on to Gab AI. They're doing that. You know, they're around. They're not that many of them either. There's just a few, and they're all very young, you know, and they're very naive and in a good way, you know, innocent. I don't mean naive. I mean, their eyes are open, but they're still very innocent, like Breitbart was. Yeah, see, Breitbart didn't understand the way the world worked. You know, he thought he did, but then he didn't, you know, but he kind of had it in Republicans versus Democrats, conservative versus liberal. You know what I mean? He had kind of a limited worldview. He didn't fathom the thing that's right underneath our civilization that runs the world. He didn't understand that part of it. See, to that, that's, you know, he, and that's what I'm trying to do is educate people so you understand that this thing, it's, you can't fool around with this. You can't just have, you know, a copy of Wiener's computer be sitting over there in Nebraska somewhere and think that, you know, all hell isn't going to break loose, you know, and probably get you all killed. You've got to understand what you're dealing with. Please, please, you know, don't be as naive as you've been out there because, you know, even if you watch the Jason Bourne movie, you see what goes on right there. That's on that level. That's light compared to what they really have. So just realize, you know, it gets to a point where, you know, when you're dealing with something like this, you know, it's the guy who knows the guy that knows the guy that knows the guy. He gets whacked too. I mean, it's evil, man. It's really, really evil. And you can't even imagine how evil these people are. They're beyond just laughing in a very glib manner about children and what they're going to do to them. You know, just like some of the banter in the emails. Most people just can't stomach it. You've never seen anything like that. Never seen that kind of attitude before, have you? As soon as they take their mask off, they're just laughing at people's demise. You've never seen what monsters these people really could be. I have seen that. I have seen it. It's frightening in the same way that if you're trapped in the Rosemary's Baby story would be frightening, terribly frightening, trying to find anywhere, somewhere for relief, someone to listen, someone to help. But everyone you go to is one of them, pretending they're your friend, and then, you know, triangulate, you know, to having it completely gang stalked 24/7, right? Tell me all about it. Tell me your problems. I'm here to listen. I'm here to listen. Are you lonely? Yes, I'm very lonely. And you've been harassed. What are people up to? What are they doing? Well, they're leaving stuff in my car and they're moving stuff around in the house. And I think they've got me on a camera and like I'll go somewhere and then they'll start saying words of like only I would know in the supermarket line and, you know, making me feel really paranoid. And how would they know that? And are they after me? And how do people know I'm here at the market and I'm wearing sunglasses? I've just been more and more shut in. I haven't been able to go out because everywhere I go, there's stuff going on. Like it's really frightening. And I just need a friend to talk to. Well, I'm your friend. I'm glad to know that how things are going. And then, of course, they take that as, you know, they take data points off that, right? And that all gets fed into the machine again. So they know they're being effective. And that's, you know, that's your shrink. That's your counselor. That's your best friend. I mean, it just goes into this nightmare, paranoid horror that is just... It's overwhelming in power because it's also supernatural that it's coming at you. So it's coming at you on a number of levels, but it's instigated from the supernatural, obviously. And the total surveillance is in the supernatural. There's 100% surveillance on every single person because every single person is a commodity in the spiritual realm. Okay, got all that said. Protection. There's always, at this point you have to, you know, there is no kind of, I suppose, walking away. The protection you're going to have is a successful seating of Trump as president. You're going to have a friend that's going to change everything. Slowly, but it won't happen overnight. You know what I mean? It won't happen overnight. There still will be electronic harassment for people that... are deemed for whatever reason to be some kind of a threat to society. And they're working on your car. They sabotage that. They do something else. One guy did something so my Volkswagen van I had before would blow up. He goes, guys, that should have blown up. And I knew I was on to him. You know, eventually I just got rid of it. I just gave him the van. I actually gave it to the mechanic because he was sabotaging it every time I take it in to try to get it to blow up. And he goes, you know, one time he comes out of character and he goes, well, your Francesca was there with me. And he looks at me, he goes, yeah, your father, this guy, you know, he's completely, he's way, everyone knows how crazy he is and all that. They don't bat an eye, but, you know, he's way out. Like, don't listen to him while he's sabotaging the thing. You know, he's actually trying to kill me while taking my money to be a mechanic. And I didn't say one thing to him. He just figured that out. The next thing you know, he's just on me. That's happened quite a few times. Anyway, they're part of the network. And, you know, it's amazing how many people... I gave him the van. I just gave it to him. It's like, okay, you win here. And I just gave the keys, walked away, and lived. I lived. Because I was smart, right, not to hang on to things. It's like, okay, here you go. You know, I just, out of the bottom of my heart, I just want you to have a gift because you're such a great guy here. And, you know, so I've been around. And this is out of the blue. Who, I don't know this guy. He's not connected to anyone else I know. How did he know? How did he get involved? He was completely. talking about how, hey, you walk into a place, nobody bats an eye. It's amazing what you get away with. I'm like, what did I do? Then he goes back to being a nice guy. What? I didn't say anything, you know. Yeah, it's like that. Well, you know, in some towns, you know, they basically live on Satan. And so anyone that isn't is a threat they feel to the town. You know, you're a threat to the town. They all kind of nod, wink, and get along. They all go to church, and they all, you know, they work on the cars. They go to the grocery store. They have their real estate businesses and their things. It all gets along fine until you show up. And then it's like you're putting a, you know, a circuit, like you're short circuiting the place. No, just by your existence, just by the fact that you're breathing, that's enough. And so things start going wrong. You know, people start, you know, losing their businesses. Things start just happening in a negative way. Pretty soon they're looking for a reason, and it's you. No one says anything. You never see it coming, but it's all of a sudden you're soft killed, right? You're persona non grata, and you don't even know what you did. You don't even know. You didn't do anything. You just went there. But see, you're not part of their club, their civilization. It's a civilization. You know, see, you don't understand, but you're that your breathing is a threat, okay? Existing, just thinking, being quietly sitting at the bus stop, waiting to get the bus to go where you got to go. That's right there. That's a complete violation. And then, you know, and nobody thinks a thing of it. You know, every other person you meet, the eyes you meet, they're looking at you with scorn, like, how dare you? How dare you ruin my town? How dare you ruin my life? I should kill you right now. You should kill yourself. And that's how stupid these people are. I mean, they are incredibly stupid. I mean, if they think they're having a life, wait till the Almighty just yanks away everything like he's done. He's already done it now. Everything has been stripped naked. They have no life. What are they going to do, live forever? No. They're going to do this. They're going to cheat on their wives. They're going to you know, cheat in business. They're going to murder each other. They're going to have a really bad life without any of you there. Then they're going to beg. We need the lambs here, they'll say. We need them. We need to feed. We just can't have all vampires. And then they're going to hate you for being there. And then when you're gone, they're going to want you again. You start to see it, please. For God, I haven't been able to be. I can't just go linearly through this thing. You have to stay with me. You know, if you can get this much, then you can be at peace. You understand, it's not your fault. You're like, you know, God made you that way. It's not your fault. You know, I went most of my life blaming myself for everything. I don't want to see you do that. I lost a lot of years that way. I don't want to see you lose even 1 year. You know, I'm really broadcasting to myself as a confused boy of 16 years old, you know, that just needed help and there was no help available. So I had the Zeff report. It would have really helped me, but it wouldn't have changed my circumstances. No, the Zeff report would not have made it so that it would be any easier, just easier because I know I'm not alone, easier because I know that it's not crazy what I'm saying, easier because I understand because others out there have a very similar experience, so I get it now. I'm starting to see it now, and that gives me a comfort so I can go on. No, because God has told me in his word, he's going to make a table for me in the midst of my enemies. I know I'm with God. I know I'm with God. Even if you don't know Jesus, you don't know the whole thing, you've never seen a Bible before, it doesn't matter. You know you belong to God completely. You know, because how? Because you know you don't belong on the other side, because look what they've done. They've made sure that you know you don't belong there, right? So by default, you belong, right? So it's just God just waiting for your free will. Just say, oh, I see you now, Father. I see you now. Oh, shoot, I see you're my real father, they're not my father. Okay, I get it, you know, and then you get on with it, you know what I mean? And then you're good to go. Look, at the end of the day, you don't want to be George Soros, do you? People like that, with that kind of spirit, they're allowed to exist here, seemingly above the law, because of the deal God made with Cain. It's the same thing. Understand? It's Cain. Soros is Cain. Go read that story in Genesis, and you'll be fine. Just look. Don't make it like you're unique, because there's a lot of brothers and sisters that you have that are going through the same struggle, and all they need is just a little glimpse of the Zapp report to realize, hey, they belong. You belong, here. It's funny how the people with the safety pins are trying to make a signal to people of color that they're cool, and I'm like, this is the most ridiculous thing in the world. These people are completely without a clue about what's going on. They're being played. They don't even know it. All these little romp room games they play with people. I have no interest to tune into it, but it's sort of like, it's this idea that, it's so sick and silly and insane that I can't look at it. I really have to just reject it. I don't have time in this life for people like that, because they're not my people. You know what I mean? They're not of God. They're not, they hate God. They hate, they hate themselves. They're blaming everything on white people now. After the white people are gone, they're going to, which will happen pretty soon. They'll start blaming on some. I was wondering, without white people here, which, that will eventually happen. Then when they're all fighting each other, who are they going to blame then? You know what I mean? They don't remember that all the Indian tribes here, they were gutting each other down and bowing and arrowing each other down. They were cutting each other down right and left, this tribe against that tribe, fighting over territory, fighting over this, fighting over that, fighting. People don't seem to, they say the Indians, the white people robbed them. And it's like, what about before that? Man, no, I don't have time. I lack the patience for that sort of thing, that kind of dialogue, and try to bring people up to speed of what happened. Yeah, I can't do it. Okay, so any one of you who've mentioned Pizzagate or the hashtag, whatever, you're on record. And so if you've never tweeted that hashtag or mentioned it or posted it on Facebook or whatever, and you don't want that harassment, and you're not really committed to it, it's not really your thing, don't do it now. That would be another cautionary thing. Don't put out the hashtag. Don't do it. Because it's not a numbers game here. It's about the rule of law, whether we're going to follow it or not. And it really all centers around Hillary Clinton anyway. I don't think they're going to get far with their gang stalking plot, but you've seen the riots, you've seen this, you've seen the manipulation of the electors. Total gang stalking on those electors. Complete. You see it, right? You see who's doing it. Soros, right? He's able to just push a button and go, okay, for all these Pizzagate people, boom, gang stalking. And so it may go on for a while. And if there's a diminished Trump, it's not going to stop. If they're able to take power from him before he's seated. Have you ever had an election that was won so overwhelmingly and then had it so frittering away at the edges, so all the cheating and lying and illegality going on? Have you ever seen anything like it? I haven't. When Obama won, what, was there cheating, lying, stealing, riots, all that? No, not at all. There was the birth of the Tea Party, which, became a political party, I suppose. There was a few things, but people basically followed the law. They followed the rule of law. They were just decent people. But it's not so on the other side. They are not decent people. They are not decent people. People that would riot, blow stuff up and burn things down and whatever, punching out somebody that had a Trump thing or killing them, which is now the threat, is not just being hit. It's basically being dead. That was all done by Soros and who's actually running the whole thing. But he has protection, the same way Cain had protection. Because, that civilization that he represents trumps this one that we're in, this kind of Disneyland thing we're in, which is fake. So it's really what's in charge. So you can see kind of who's president, who's boss. The president we elect isn't really completely president. In the case of Trump, he would be, But it's the thing about Trump that's so interesting, and all of them, is that there's another force here, far more powerful than Obama, Soros, and all the rest of it, times infinitely. So I say it's like a God force. But it also has otherworldly components to it. I'm not going to get into that. But I've saw it, okay? And so I'm going to take heart with that, and I'm not going to worry. I'm not going to worry because I just like, you know, it's what I've seen so far is that I've seen a tremendous onslaught against Trump that was enough to take out anyone, any army of people, and the guy just kept, you know, it's like it blew up in their face, and then another plot with the raped girls or whatever that blew up in his face. It blew up in their face, and it's just like no matter what they threw, it just, you know, the same thing with, you know, every single thing. But it's been like a constantly, it's like watching a cartoon, watching these people throw the next obstacle, which is the certification of the vote by the 13th of December. Okay, the next obstacle. Okay, well, they won't be ready because Jill Stein, one person could throw out the entire election and everyone let her do it, especially that Obama selected judge in Michigan. Okay. He just decided to charge the people several million dollars to the taxpayer and have one person that's got nothing at stake here with no proof or evidence of any wrongdoing hold up the entire process with a hand count of ballots, which probably won't be done by in a state that's already had two recounts or one recount and already certified the vote. Not possible. Unbelievable, right? But let's watch what happens. People kept saying, you know, I keep seeing, you know, like Pennsylvania seems to have gone poof, but I mean, I don't know. I'm just saying, look at what they do. Know them by their fruits. Know them by their fruits. okay, well, I know you're concerned, but the really awful thing that I could feel it, okay, throughout my whole body, my head to my toes, to my arms and legs, my torso, everything, I feel the horror of the same horror I felt when I was a child, when I was like three, about this world, okay? The world that you got a glimpse of with Pizzagate. It's not, you know, it's the satanic world, which is basically a horror movie. They love it. They love people like Jeffrey Dahmer and Charles Manson and Richard Ramirez, and those are heroes of these people. I've been in their homes before. You know, my friend was a producer of horror movies, and you know, one time we went to this guy's house, which was on Cielo Drive in Beverly Hills. I don't think I can't even recount the story. Let me just put it this way: these people that this was a financier, and you know, he had to live, you know, in that house of, you know, Sharon Tate, and he had to. You know what I mean? I'll just put it that these are very macabre people. They worship, you know, like they were doing the movie Ed Gein, okay? That's just who they are, you know, and this guy put up the money for it. And I was there on another matter, on another film that my producer friend took me there because I was a writer then, you know. Anyway, I've talked about that before, but why did he have to live there on Cielo? And why did he have to... Why does he worship all these people that are serial killers? Why do they? Why, you know, and he's drinking, absinthe, and his parties turn into orgies. And same thing. It's the same thing, although I don't think there's any murder there. But this is a typical Hollywood situation. You know, it's a world that you can't believe it when you just can't believe it, you know. And you sit there talking about, you know, being reasonable. And I don't even know how I wound up in the horror thing. But these people, when they do horror movies, you have to understand, a lot of them are Crowleyites. They're coming from that world. And I remember I drove him to the set of a film he was producing. And I can't remember. We were up all night, you know, and doing drugs and stuff. And then the sun's coming up and I feel really lousy. And I'm kind of lost and I'm feeling terrible, and as soon as we get there, some of the crew starts harassing me. I'm in this truck, doing him a favor and driving him out to the set. And I don't even know what film they were doing. I think it was might have been the Ed Gein thing. He won an award for that, actually. But and we got out there, and I'm like, I don't see how you could actually make it through the day here after that sort of trashing overnight. But, you know, the crew there was just like, you know, I don't know them. I'm just dropping them off. They're going to have a shoot. They, you know, if they get there in the wee hours to shoot during the day. And then I'm just dropping them off and leaving. And the crew, they just jump on me and start. I said, what is that? Why are they harassing me? What did I do? It was like, oh, yeah. So the real question is, how did they know that I would be even driving you out here? Yeah. Okay. Well, anyway, see, that's the sort of thing that gets people to be shut-ins, right? Especially if you don't know what's happening. You know, where the hell did that come from? I'm just some, you know, guy in a truck dropping off, you know, the producer here, and they're going to be shooting in an hour. I think it was, now I remember. I don't think it was it? No, it wasn't Ed Gein. It was another one. I think it was the Hillside Strangler that he did. I think that was it. And the director was a guy that he picked up out of a movie that Reese Witherspoon was in, and he directed that, and he liked that, and eventually he got the job. And so, yeah, okay. So that was it. Long time ago, right? Long time ago. You know, some of you were not even born yet. And, but again, it's this weird kind of harassment. Now, what was the offense? Right at that time, I was, you know, coming to the Lord. Like within a very short time after that, I had hit bottom, you know, and I reached out to God, and He was there to lift me up. And I've just been walking out ever since, you know. He was just reminding me who I really was. Because it had been the same fight all along. I just got to the point where I was at the end of my rope. I just realized I can't win. I can't exist. I can't make it. You know what I mean? I kept trying and trying and trying and trying and trying. And, you know, this guy who's my friend, but my enemy, my frenemy, really. You know, and then he became my friend later. He walked out of Hollywood. He's had a similar experience, but I didn't reject him. But he was like a double agent. You know, it was a whole horrible, confusing thing. But anyway, it's, I know you can relate. Even though this is a more exotic story involving Hollywood and stuff, I know you can relate. You know, anyone who can identify with Randy Quaid can relate, right? It's just bizarre. It's how people on the set, you know, the crew, you got three crew guys, you know, starting to, you know, hey, where are you going? Hey, you know, I'm like, what? I'm just, you know, yeah, it's quite amazing. And eventually, soon thereafter, it was probably within a couple of weeks after that point, or maybe a month or two or something, is when I finally just collapsed and gave everything over to the Almighty God. And He showed me eventually the Bible and Jesus and the whole, you know, kind of the whole thing. But that He also showed me the churches and Trish too. And Trish did the same thing. When the Lord picked me up, He literally had me up off the ground. I was up the ground. I felt like I was off the ground, 6 feet off the ground, to prove it was really real, you know. And then, you know, with Trish, it's like, you know, we had the journey through the churches after that, because we thought, oh, well, now you go to church, because you had this, and everyone I told about this experience, you know, and they all said it was demonic and whatever. It's like, well, one thing I know about the demonic, it's not good, and it doesn't last. It's not consistent, right? So people that pray to demons are stupid, because it's like on again, off again, on again. You know, they have power to give you, but it's dirty power. You don't want it. So with this, it has been from that day to today, unbroken chain. And I'm not that consistent. So, you know, by now you know it is the Almighty, right? Plus, you don't, you know, the show is also bears witness to that fact. So, yeah, that's the only, you know, I was telling someone the other day, I said, you know, people sometimes look up to me because I, you know, I'm kind of a living sacrifice here doing this show, which is just basically like soft killing yourself to help other people out that might be in my predicament. Well, the thing is I owed it to the Lord, first of all, number one, for saving, you know, he brung me to the dance. So I dance with the one who brung me. I don't have any life of my own or anything to protect of my own. He's the main thing. And if he wants me to help the kids who are like 18, 17, 16, 25, who don't understand what's happening, rather than committing suicide, be better that they live, right? So I have compassion for those people because that was me. And a lot of them, you know, friends I had did commit suicide because they just couldn't handle the thing that you've looked into with Pizzagate, you've heard, it's that laughter. You know what I mean? That the demeaning of like, that kind of like, arrogance and laughter about people suffering, you know, that while they then pose as the big charity givers, they pose as the big people who are compassionate and trying to help the little guy when they're really just the opposite. You know, when you see that and you realize they just laugh at you when you go to them for help, you know, come on, you know, get over yourself. You know what I mean? And they insult you and they're mean. And many and many, many a child has been driven even by their parents to suicide. Because they couldn't believe the world that they suddenly glimpsed into when suddenly the masks were off and then they were all the same civilization, a civilization that you yourself are not in and you wouldn't belong anyway, feeling so alone, so alienated, so absolutely without. And then everyone you go to for help turns out to be another one, another setup. What do you do? How do you survive? And that's, you know, because that's my motivation, you know, to do this, because to help other people to understand, to get a heads up early on in life so that you realize, you know, the Lord has us here for a purpose and it's for a great purpose because he's great. It's for good because he's good. They're not good. They're not here for a good purpose. You see the way they pay for these riots and they do all this stuff. They say it's all grassroots when it's all fake. You know, it's you see what they do and then how they laugh behind the scenes at all the little people and they laugh at how stupid the Hillary voters are. Hillary laughs at how stupid her own voters are. Caught on camera, caught on tape. And the people vote anyway because they just do what they're programmed to do. It's because they're in this web of Satan. But they're there mainly, I hate to say it, and let me just say this very clearly so everyone can hear it. They're there of their own free will. They made that decision. They didn't have to tell you about it. So you're being very naive if you think that these people just accidentally sitting over there. No, it's a big deal being over there. You have to make a big decision. You make a big free will decision. You made that decision. You're giving them a pass. You're wrong. You've been programmed by the churches to not see what's true. All right? I yelled. Because I just... you got to stop being naive. Stop being naive. Because that'll get you killed. You can't just think this Disneyland thing is real. Number one, the real world you don't see because you're not in it. They're in it, though. And you have to realize your handicap here. You've got to fully rely on God. And then if he says, don't get in that car and go over there, or don't go this way, or don't go that, don't do it. Don't go by your own logic. You'll never make it. You know, and haven't we learned from our mistakes? How many times have we walked into the trap? I walked into it just over and over again. I just wouldn't learn. I just said, oh, it can't be that way. Cognitive dissonance. I refuse to believe the world is what it is. And now, I mean, I know what it is. And, you know, I've come into the knowledge of what it is, I seem to have lost interest in, well, entertainment, movies, TV, music from other people, you know. Just in general, it's just kind of, you know, it's okay. It's like when I grew up, when I was a child, I outgrew Disneyland, literally. I used to like to go to Disneyland in Anaheim, and then later on we'd abuse it. We'd go do drugs, like LSD and stuff and go to Disneyland because that was really a trip, you know, and that was stupid as can be. But yeah, you know, yeah, all that happened. And but you grew out of it, like between, you know, 12 and 13, and you think you're so smart and you think you're so worldly. And little did I know there was a satanic thing back then, but Satan uses drugs to get the kids on his side, right? Parents look the other way because they don't want to do it, so they figure maybe the peers will do it for them. And then once the kid's over there, then the parents go, hey, looky, me too, you know? And they all have a kumbaya session. What I describe here at the Zuff Report is actually the real world. What I just described to you in a kind of a light manner, that last few sentences I just said, is exactly what it is. You want to know something? I would search far and wide in this earth, in libraries, books, fiction especially, to find anyone that would tell me what this is. Anyone. Does anyone know? And I couldn't find it. You know, the Bible was the closest, not perfect, but, you know, you can look into, you could go deep, though, in certain things, and you can see it, like Ezekiel, you know, 17, you see it, you see Elijah prophets of Baal story, some other, you know, there's, it's there, but because we've been so conditioned to, when it's in plain sight, not see it, you know, how do they do that to us? You know, all this, the whole pedophile networks and all this stuff, it's in plain sight. You know, it's down at the school. It's over, certainly at the church. It's over there. And it's powerful because people get killed. You know, if you're surrounded by it, you say, oh, I see it. You're a pervert. Then you're in danger. You see, that's the way it's been all over the world. Now, these people are going, screaming, hey, over here. And so they're going to try to localize it at Comet Ping Pong and make it like, oh, it's there. It's there. Maybe a little bit with the rumors about the Clinton Foundation are false. It's there. Or it's really the Clinton Foundation. Or it's this, or it's Soros. That's it. It'd be Mr. Evil, right? So it's him. Or no, it's over there in the entertainment world in La La Land. No, it's... No, I'm sorry. But Satan is real, okay? We're all taught he's not real, and is everywhere. And more everywhere than anything else. He's the all-seeing eye, meaning every soul is surveilled because it's property. So then that's what's going on here. Now we have this poor excuse of a civilization kind of suffused on top of it. And then, you know, but I mean, it's God's will, you know, I'm not going to say it's not. But then we have, you know, Cain's kind of in charge, right? And then there's a protection there. How come these people are above the law? You might say, well, because they're under the covering of Cain. An ancient covenant to make Cain live so there would be good versus evil. So you can join the Cainites, if you will. I put that in quotes. Not literally, but a spiritual Cainite. And you can become a lizard. You know, like I say, lizards. They're the lizards. You can become one of them through free will. If you go read the story of Nimrod, you'll see how he did it. You'll see how it's done. That, you know, it's amazing the physical changes people go through when they cross that line. I mean, they actually change physically and physical appearance as well. It's nothing to me, but see, we're naive when we don't factor all that in. See, because that's, you're naive if you think the gang stalking is just like electronic harassment and you can't really get to the bottom of it, or where you're following the perps around trying to get to the bottom. You'll never get to the bottom of it that way. No, and they'll never get to the bottom of it by focusing on Comet Ping Pong and Pizzagate. That's not the way to find out what's going on. It should just be an inspiration to take the big leap and find out the whole thing is a sham, if you will. The whole thing is a theater at best for the purpose of harvesting souls. Okay? That's what you're up against. You know, they know who you are. They know where you're going. They know where you're going to go tomorrow. They know where you're driving. They know where you're, they know everything about you. They know everything. There is nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. The surveillance they have is ultra dimensional. It's like you're in an ant farm and being watched. You don't know who the people are. Why? You think the ant farm is it. And then if you're going the wrong way, they prod you a little bit to get you to go that way or prod you to get you to go this way. I mean, that's what you're up against, folks. I mean, look, I'm not going to whitewash it here or sweet talk it or make it, you know, I can't make the horror movie go away. Okay, it is horrific. Every day of our lives is horrific. When you understand where you're living, what this is. People go, oh, but I have so many blessings. And they say, yes, they're blessings. Yes, be thankful. But because of this situation, you know, one of the worst things that people do is they say, oh, our troubles are over now. We're in the clear. No, Gideon. You know, keep those eyes on the perimeter. You get a blessing, you still got to be heads up, you know. Be sober, be vigilant, because your enemy, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion looking for whom he can devour. That's right. They're devouring people. They're devouring children. They're devouring all kinds of things. And we live in a dangerous place where we are the hunted, okay? And so because you are the hunted, you know that there's never going to be another day in your life where you can just kind of like go and relax in the hammock and think your troubles are over. Relax in the hammock, all right. But don't think, you know, you can take your eyes off that perimeter. That's all I'm saying. Realize that all good things come from God. Okay, that reminds me. See, good old David, he went through that back then. It's nothing new. This targeting of people, gang stalking, want to call it that. It's the same thing as a spiritual battle. Defaming a person. Jesus said, if they bear false witness, rejoice, because obviously they did that to me. They'll do it to you. There's nothing new under the sun. They are spreading rumors about you, trying to discredit you for looking into shaming you for even broaching the subject of any kind of Pizzagate or some child trafficking, this wild stuff, trying to blame Clinton and all this stuff that came out of mainly the election or WikiLeaks, is, you know, debunking that as a conspiracy. While they're, you know, they've got WikiLeaks, they're going to probably have WikiLeaks sully themselves coming up here pretty soon with some really nasty kind of releases that aren't true, that can get debunked, so it will then debunk this. They will do all of that, friends, and more. They have put billions into quashing this thing, manipulating the entire media globally. And then, of course, you know, now that WikiLeaks is compromised, they can always have WikiLeaks release all kinds of cockamamie stuff that makes WikiLeaks look more and more marginalized or more and more fringy. And then that will go toward the Podesta emails being just BS or hacked or whatever, or rewritten, or, you know, something, some kind of plot from Trump, and Trump supporters did it. So then if they have to go to war with the Trump supporters, meaning take the presidency away and then put these people in internment camps and execute them, yes, why wouldn't they? Once you're deemed an enemy of the state, they interred the Japanese here. Why wouldn't they? If that becomes, you know, the enemy. The whole state of California has geared up to fight Trump. That's the whole purpose of the government of California. It's unbelievable. Never seen so, you know, and what's the result that's happened already? And, you know, a lot of these people, I don't even think they voted. You know, the people who are researching this are not necessarily Trump supporters, but they're trying to lump it all into Breitbart, extremist, Trump, Alex, you know, various people, trying to lump it all then in together as one big social pariah that needs to be excised out of our society so we can have a decent society. And that's basically, they've gone nuts. And no, when they kill you, they will make no sense. They'll justify it in some way. But, you know, we hope it doesn't get to that point. That's the benefit of the internet. That's the benefit of shows like this one. We don't want it to get to that point. We don't want to be struck down by violent people that are just unhinged and violent. And they just, if they see a Trump sticker, they burn the car, they blow the car up with no consequences. In most cases, not all cases, but most cases, no consequence. Good job, nod wink. Yeah, you're not protected right now. Same thing with Christians. People say, well, you shouldn't call yourself a Christian. That's a pagan term. It's like, you know, okay, fine. You know, I'm not even going to go there. I just, you know, I understand all the wiles of the enemy. If he can get us to divide and conquer, then, you know, divide. And let's have an argument about, you know, while all this is going on, let's talk about the names of God, why don't we? Or let's talk about the concept of the Bible being false. Or let's talk about, you know, I'm just not going there, you know, again. I'm just going to try not to go there again. You know, I know my faith, I know my walk, I know my God, and I'm just going to keep on after that. We're not going to spend time arguing over various definitions. You know, I just got to go with what works, and that's it. You know, what works? Survival works. Protection works. But I pray for the protection of these children. I think we all should have a heart for children. If there's 8 million missing and 800,000 in the U.S., and that's the government statistics, it's maybe more than that. If that's the case, we all need to be vigilant, don't we? We can't have our children being overrun in our nation. We can't have migrants coming in, you know, people had given everything and then raping people and killing people and then having no punishment. There has to be some way of stopping the lawless ones who happen to be on the side for, you know what side they're on, right? You know what candidate they want. You know what where they're at. And, you know, do I see anything on the other side that kind of accusing a Trump supporter of cheating? We haven't seen that. So it's just a spiritual thing. You know, it's like there's people online that are on this recount thing, because sometimes I'll go hashtag recount and I'll try to see what's going on. And they're just 2.5 million people that donated to Jill Stein are quietly waiting for Hillary Clinton to be named president. They are waiting, literally. Everyone denies this, but they're all waiting there for her to be deemed president, and they're looking forward, and get this part, they are looking forward to fighting the Trump people after shaming them by taking the president away, putting Hillary in there, and then prosecuting them by law for their very existence, whether they did anything wrong or not. That's what they... it's not enough to just put Hillary in. They believe that the Trump supporters all need to be punished and possibly rounded up and put in FEMA camps. And they're quietly looking forward to her being there and then backing her in prosecuting and punishing the Trump people, tying it to the alt-right and to this Pizzagate, to all these nasty rumors of the things they've done, and blaming all of them at once, even with the threat of violence on the streets, if they see them, allowed to kill them with impunity, without worrying about repercussions, because they're doing society a favor. Just don't get caught. That's the attitude. And I'm just characterizing the attitude, okay, of say, you know, a cross-sampling of people. They are extremely violent, extremely angry, and they want Hillary to be, you know, Trump to be unseated, Hillary to be seated, and then the real thing they want. Okay, that's not enough. They want to punish. You've heard mainstream people saying, the guy with this spice company, he says that it's not, he's not even talking about Trump anymore. He goes, the Trump supporters must be punished. And so I'm sure when a Trump supporter gets beaten up or gets killed, and probably there's been people killed that's been covered up, I'll bet, or not reported on. But let's just put it this way. He would cheer on the killing of any Trump person as part of the punishment. You know, if you, the very least you'll get is a beatdown, and that's what he's advocating as a big CEO. So just think what the rank and file is doing. That's persecution on steroids, okay? And if they were able to do all their evil plans and succeed, you wouldn't want to live here. You would be in serious trouble. Now, nothing ever goes according to plan, you know, and I've seen this plans of the evil people. They're evil people, and they blow up time and time again, over and over again, because I think God is doing a work here with all this. And yes, and I've seen it, and if it's going to go to equilibrium, it's got to go all the way into the light, all this stuff, And so we're just going to see it all go. Not that any one of us is perfect. Not that Trump is perfect. Certainly no savior of anybody. But it's just like God is just doing a thing here, okay? And it's people of, you know, the righteous people here, that is people that are not Satanists. Thank you. They may be sinners, but they're still righteous in Christ. You know, they're believers and they're fairly humble and they're not. Do any of you think of yourselves as anything great? You've been beaten down enough, have you? It's not even a question in your mind anymore. You just aren't great. And that's just the way it is. Most people that I know are in that category. I say to people, you know, they say, I really want to meet you. I say, no, you don't want to meet me, because the minute you meet me, you're going to be disappointed. Because I got, you know, problems that you would, you know, I've got issues and things you wouldn't respect. I'm sure you do too. And it's just, you know, it's if you have no expectation, then that's one thing. But when you're a voice on the, you know, on the air, people expect more. And I say, I'm sorry to disappoint you. I may be good at speaking and have authority in my voice, but I'm a mess like you. I'm working on it too. I'm struggling with some things too. And I've just nothing great here, nothing to see here, you know? And I used to have some kind of modest delusions of grandeur from time to time, you know, thinking I had something going on or whatever, but those have been beaten down and beaten out and shamed and shame and guilt and shame and guilt. And after a while, you just try to do stuff without putting an expectation on it. You know, like, well, what's the reaction? Am I good? Am I bad? What do you think? You know, and I've at this point, you know, whether it's a podcast or it's a piece of music or, you know, a piece of writing or whatever it is that I produce, you know, and now it's gotten to the point where the Lord just beat the crap out of me on all that stuff. So it's just like, you know, they say, well, how many plays did that get? I said, well, three. And you know, oh, that's awful. No, it's not. I don't care. 1,000, you know, 10,000, 2, 1. It's all the same. Once he breaks you, it all becomes the same. You produce what you do, what you produce. So those of you who've gotten discouraged, I know there's a couple of you out there with music and such. You're not discouraged. The Lord's breaking you of something. You have an ego problem. You want feedback. You want to know. You're defining yourself by what others think of you still. You know, I know the insecure musician and artist. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm just saying the Lord won't tolerate that. He will get you to the point of creating whatever you're creating out of the joy of creating it and let the chips fall where they may. Isn't that a much happier existence? Isn't that a much happier state of life that you're like when the birds are singing, do they want to ask, hey, how am I sounding? No, they sing, you know, and you too. You just get out there, create whatever you're going to create, and you know, stop looking at some result of what numbers are, how many people, you know, chime in, or if you get any comments. Well, the Lord had to break me of that, and it's been, you know, there's some very, you know, if I took it that way, like the world does, I suppose I'd be so humiliated, I would never show my face again. But it's like, no, I like to create because it's a joy in my heart, and it's the Lord made me to, you know, to create. And so I do, but I just freely give it, you know. And as far as the results, that's not my job to look at the results. Oh, I see them, and people try to shame me once in a while. And then you'll see something else where it's got an extraordinary amount of plays. It's like, well, that's not my favorite song. This other one I really like, but look, everyone hates it. You know, that kind of talk, everyone hates it. No, they don't hate it. They're just, you know, it's also supernatural. You know, if they flip the switch, you have thousands of plays. Who cares? You're still the same person. You're still not sure. Is it any good? I don't know. No one's heard it yet. Wait a second. Of course it's good. I produce out of joy. It's good. I put it out there. You know, of course it's good. If other people don't agree, that's fine. You know, it doesn't matter. But the only way you can get to that point, you insecure musicians, is this. He, the Lord God, has to break us. And he'll usually do that by having you be disappointed every day of your life. Everything you put out there, oh, gee, what's the use, you'll say. You know, nobody cares anyway. And then go sulk in the corner until he's finally going to break you down so far that you just get free of that kind of thinking. And all of a sudden you're like, wow, it's all a joy, you know? And it's like, yeah, the breaking of that old man of the world and the new man in Christ is what it's all about. It's like a metaphor of that, or almost like an allegory of the breaking of the old man and the birth of the new, dying to self, but living in Christ. The same thing, when you put out something, you need applause. Well, he's going to break you of that idea of getting applause. The only one you should be really thinking about is him, not applause. You know, if they like it, fine. If they don't like it, fine. You know, they can, another thing that's wrong with that kind of thinking is like, that means you're susceptible to flatteries. And if they can corrupt you through flatteries, like, you'd like to hear good stuff about yourself. And that's a great way the devil could just take you and just, you know, wreck your life. Whether you abase or whether you abound, it's all the same in Christ, really. It's all the same. It's no different. If someone pays attention to it, if they like it or if they don't like it, doesn't matter. It's just the same, same day, same thing, you know, pushing on to Christ. You're pushing on to the Lord. You're pushing on to, you know, through this thing, you know, you're grateful he's getting you through it. So the works that you have, whether you write books or whether you write poetry or whether you write, do podcasts or whether you do music or whether you do movies or whatever you do, it doesn't matter what anyone thinks. But see, if it does within you and you can't change it, right? You're a human being and, you know, you bust your ass because you want mommy to tell you, oh, what a great job, as if that's going to cure anything. What's the first thing you think after mommy tells you what a great job you did? You say, the next thing you go is, really? Which proves that you're screwed, man. You know, because then you don't believe mommy anymore. They're all applauding, but maybe it's rigged, you know. Why suddenly is there approval? Then that creates a whole other list of anxieties. If you're broken of that and you don't care about the result and you don't chase it around, there's a great peace in that. There's a great joy in that. Let things happen the way they're going to happen. You know? That's just, you know, fair advice. I mean, that's all I can say. People tweet, they go, well, this one got 50 retweets and 50 likes or whatever, and this one got 2. So? What if they get 0? So? What does it matter what happens to your tweets? It doesn't. If it does matter to you, then you have a problem. You see, that's the same problem the world has when they cross that line, because they want the approval of mommy. They want to when they say, really, it's, oh, you're the best. You've always been the best. I mean, nobody could beat you, sonny boy. And that just keeps you in an infantile state, doesn't it? Wanting, you know, mommy to approve of you in your high chair with your baby rattle. And, you know, it's a losing proposition, especially men. Because men have still been programmed to be, you know, the breadwinners, the success stories. And once you're broken of any notion of having success, in other words, it's irrelevant. Whether you succeed or fail, it becomes irrelevant. That's total freedom, my friend. That is total peace and total freedom. That's what dying to Christ is, picking up your cross. That's what it's all about. And then, you know, oddly enough, when you finally get to that point, oddly enough, you start seeing more clearly. Now, you know, sometimes I'll be working on a tune in the studio and I'll say to Trish, hey, how's it sound, Trish? And she'll go, it sounds great. You know, it sounds good. It sounds okay. Whatever. Really? You know, and I'll catch myself doing that. Other times when I'm really free, it's like she could walk by, let's say if the door is open or whatever. A lot of times I keep it closed. But it's open and closed, just depends. I have 2 mixing settings, one for the door open, and then I've got one on the speakers. The speakers electronically, we shot the room with a microphone. So we have different mix positions with the speaker. It's a little complex, but it's basically like this. The speakers adjust depending on whether that door is open, not open, whether I'm back behind the drums, up front, side, you know, wandering around, whatever. We have settings for those. So the speakers give a fairly accurate image. Does it work well? No, it does not work well. I don't think any speaker in there would succeed. It's just too many things are in that room, and I'm surrounded with instruments, and they all have reflective surfaces, and so, you know, there you go. But that's okay, because my real reference at point is a mid-level headphones give you the best mixes overall in terms of devices, and that's like, you know, what do I use? I use the, my favorites are the the Shure SRH-940, which is the mid-level. Why? Because that sounds best on, you know, iPad, iPhone, laptop, high-end speakers, low-end speakers, in the car, whatever. I'm going for that kind of mix that can be in real-world situations. I'm not going for an audiophile type of mix. And I can't, a high-end pair of earphones, you're not going to get there. Low-end, not going to get there either. I found the sweet spot with these, and I've been having these, you know, year in and year out. I just broke a pair. I had to replace them. But yeah, you know, and the reviews aren't good. You go in the reviews, it's like 3 stars. You know what I mean? And it's like, I don't pay attention to reviews, right? Mine or anybody else's. So I just go for what works. And also what feels good and what has the least fatigue, the most fun, you know, and can get you there. Like if you have overamping bass, you hear, if you have a kick drum that's, you know, or a snare that needs to be tamed, you can hear it. And with the speakers are good. I mean, you know, don't get me wrong. The speakers are good, you know, use monitors if, you know, good, but most rooms are not really fit for the, you know, you have to, you know, I go back and forth. Don't catch whatever the problem is with the speakers. I have my headphones mid-level. I learned that the hard way. I had a pair of Sennheiser HD800s or something like that. You know, some, you know, I'd say, well, these are really good for mastering. And back then, they're like 1500, 1600, or 1800, whatever, a pair. Ridiculous sum of money for a pair for cans. But they were terrible for mixing, awful for mastering. And terrible for listening because they were, you know, so good that, you know, you needed like a Deutsche Grammophon recording of the, you know, London Philharmonic and such cathedral using such and such microphones with the top engineers of the world doing it. And then they would really come to life. but it like rock and roll, no. And that, whether it's Led Zeppelin or your own mix or whatever, no. You want to go down in quality to get the good mix. It's something that's counterintuitive, so most people don't understand. You're doing just fine there with a set of cans and your laptop. If that's all you have, no audio interface, whatever, you know what? You're going to mix for real-world circumstances there. You know, if you need an interface because you need to input something, fine. I think on that tune, Saturnal, I actually used the mic in the laptop itself in the MacBook. It's several years old now too. I used that mic and it was fine. You know, I mean, it wasn't great, but it got the job done. And, so, you know, I would just encourage you if that's your thing. I would, if I had to have my choice between say a pair of, Rich has a good pair of monitors called the LSRs. I just saw those. They're by JBL. And let me give you a tip. You can get those for $99 for a pair. And they are the highest end monitor you're probably ever going to get your hands on. They're the 308s, LSR 308s. I saw them for $99. I couldn't believe it because they sold for a whopping $150 per pair. That's unheard of. Anyway, my friend Rob is a rep for JBL, okay? I said, what's with these speakers? I mean, what is this? And he said, we have speakers called the M2, okay? They come with, he tried to sell me a pair. They're like $20,000 for the pair. They have crown amplifiers that come with them that they're each one has a mono amp and whatever. It's kind of a complicated thing. But anyway, the M2, he goes, the same technology that's in the M2, okay, which is their top of the line for JBL. the main technology, it's a new technology, they put in these LSRs just to see if people would pick up on it. So if I were to recommend, you would have to spend, to do better than that, you'd have to go to a Triumph, you know, Genelec like what I have, and it may not be better than that. Or to like a high-end Focal or one of those, or, you know, or another JBL. But $99 for an accurate monitor that's as good as EM2, kind of ridiculous. There is no other speaker on the market like that. $99, and you could be, you know, and you would never need another pair of speakers. As far as, you know, mixing, you might want some for listening pleasure, you know, something more beefy that give you, you know, but as far as detailed accuracy, you know, look no further. I got the word from the engineer. I know exactly what they did there. They did it because they didn't think people, they wondered whether people were actually going to figure that out. And they sort of did. I bought KRK speakers. They suck compared to those. I bought all kinds of speakers that were more money than that, including some Tannoys that were really good, but I, you know, blew them up eventually, and, you know, they're very well made. None of it, you know, they don't have that same technology. So that's just a tip for those of you who are, you know, looking for speakers, or you might have even more expensive speakers and you want something that's going to give you accuracy. That's it. Barring that, though, in fact, the headphones that I use are more expensive than those. You know, but I would prefer at the end of the day, if I had to have one thing, I would have a laptop and headphones. If that's all I had, I would have these cans and that laptop, and that's what I would do, because I know that I would get a good result. And I'd have Pro Tools and all that, because I need, you know, you need that quality of the software and stuff. But yeah, that and a little, you know, MIDI keyboard, and I'm good to go. I happen to have, you know, a regular studio and all that, but I'm just saying that if you make the right choices, you know, you can do it very inexpensively and do very high-end work. In fact, there's some guy I saw that had a hit on the radio that he did from Reason and an Apple laptop, and he went from there to, you know, a chart topper. I forget the song. So it can be done, ladies and gentlemen. It just takes the will. Where there's a will, there's a way. Now let's get back to this horror movie we're living in. So right now, and this happens also every year, every Christmas, this time of year, you get this horror movie feeling, you know, and we always go, oh, but we have turkey coming up and we have family dinner and, you know, Christmas festivities and all that, but it turns into a horror movie, a nightmare for some of us. And it happens every year. And there's this thing where you should be happy and you should be looking forward to celebrating and all this stuff. And all this other stuff ramps up. The gang stalking, let's say, if that's your issue that you're struggling with, that starts ganging up. Or the people that are, you know, the spiritual warfare, which is what I like to call everything, including, you know, I don't believe in mechanical gang stalking so much as I believe the spiritual warfare overall. And then the manifestations would be people manifesting, you know, in various ways. So that could include, that's like a catch-all that includes every nasty thing that could happen to you. Okay, so you're just there embattled, and it seems like the battle's ramping up. Because why? Because most people go to sleep at that time, and that's when the enemy just gets, you know, riled up and starts pulling stuff right and left even more. So I'm not surprised that we have this elector thing, you know, certifying the votes, getting that done by the 13th, and then having the electors go at the 19th, having the Congress reconvening on the 6th, and then having the seating of the president, the inauguration on the 20th. That's a lot of time for shenanigans. You know, then the other thing is they're beaming everybody with this kind of like witchcraft waves, I call them. Maybe not mechanical. That's right. That's spiritual warfare. A general feeling of malaise. And then, of course, you know, the divisions in families are going to be huge this year. There's going to be people, there may be people getting killed right and left here too, just in family feuds. This is the year of division. But, you know, ultimately, God is dividing the sheep and the goats. He's just doing it, and we can't do anything about it. You know, it's going to happen just like as sure as you're standing there. The light's going to be coming in more and more, already is. And, you know, John Wayne's writing in the form of Trump, but, you know, they're trying to stop him because John Wayne represents the end of everything they hold dear, which is your demise. And it's just an incredible shifting and changing of the guard, which is exciting. And they're not going to take that away from us, okay? I guarantee that changing the guard is going to go through. You're not going back to the 1930s. You're not going back to the Bolsheviks. You're not going to, they're never going to get their way again. You have to understand, this is the end of them. It's just how much pain and suffering is there on the way to that point. That's what we're trying to figure out, because I've already picked up on the gang stalking. That's already going on with these people. You know, they're, of course they're being surveilled. Of course they're focused. But it's whether or not people start, you know, actively going at it and you know, polluting the minds of the neighbors and the co-workers and people mysteriously getting fired because they had one tweet about Pizzagate. You know, that kind of thing, you know, across the board. They believe. I've got to talk really fast, get all this in, because I can't do it. Some people, they have a gift of wit. The wit, you know, brevity is the soul of wit. I just can't. There's just too much to go over. I can't get it done. You know, I mean, just all the things that are going on, I'm trying to, you know, get it all into an understandable format so we could really look at it and then learn from it and grow and get, you know, have the right perspective and the right attitude, and, you know, which is anything but a defeatist attitude. That's not us right now. It's more like we're embattled, yes. It's a struggle, yes, but not defeated, right? Not how you feel? Okay. You pop the champagne after you're dead, all right? So what we're going to do now is you know, we have to get through this period of time. Now, next Monday, the 19th, next Thursday is the 15th. So if you go back, so it's 14th, 13th, 12th. So I guess the 12th and 13th is like what, Monday and Tuesday? And then you've got the 19th on Monday, a week from Monday, right? So over the next 2-week period is just really a big thing. Because we've already seen one false flag. You know, regarding it, you know, I don't separate the child trafficking scandal, the Clinton Foundation, Soros trying to buy the election, threatening with death. By the way, death threats are illegal. You know, Soros orders them up. No one gets in trouble. They can make death threats. You cannot. They can. You can't. They can. You can't. They can. You. Who? Where are we? Who are we? What are we? They can make death threats. You cannot. John Q. Citizen, on that other side, can make all the death threats he likes. You cannot. It's been like that for years and years. That's going to change. See, they're deathly afraid. In other words, if you live, they die. If they live, you die. If you live, they die. That's how they see it. That's that soul survivor kind of mentality. Your thriving is my death. I got to make sure I get in the government, I control the government, and stop you from thriving. Just like I locked down California, I made sure no one could be successful there because I got it locked down. You know, I got a wealth tax on people, got all kinds of, make sure they keep them contained. You know, because if you thrive, I die. If you don't need me, I die. So by going this way, totalitarian, I could force you to like me as the news media. I could force you to need me as the sugar daddy. I could force you to love me and do what I tell you. But I mean, if you thrive in freedom, if you want more freedom, then I die. If you want success with your business, I die. If Trump brings success and starts bringing jobs back, we're screwed. And that's why they plan to vote no on whatever he does, to make sure that you don't thrive and that you have no freedom. And that's basically what they want, because they don't, your bondage is their freedom. Your freedom is their bondage. Once you understand that about how it works, two opposites, right? Then, you know, on a seesaw, yeah, one goes down, the other goes up, the other goes down, the other goes up. Once you understand that's the way it is, now you can see everything very clearly. They seek to infiltrate the government to put you down so they can thrive. Only a parasite would do that. If I was in government, I'd want to see you thrive. You know, that's not a parasite. So I'm going to take over everything, the regulations, everything, to make sure I put you out of business, farmers. I put you out of business, small business owners. I make you dependent on me while I take everything from you and I get bigger and bigger and bigger while you diminish. Otherwise, I die. If I'm not growing, I'm dead. And if you know there's a person like that seeking office, you immediately say, whether they're Republican or Democrat, it doesn't matter. If you know that's the kind, you're right, you have to, really we need to distinguish between the parasites and the producers. The parasites want everyone to fail, you know, but to redound to their benefit. The producers, if they were to get in positions of government, which a lot of times they don't seek government, which is sad, but they would want you to produce, do your thing, whatever it is, make T-shirts, kites, salt and pepper shakers, whatever you're doing. And they want to see you succeed. Because when you succeed, we all succeed. When you go down, we all go down. You know, so we want everyone to succeed. I want humanity to succeed. I want people to be able to do what their dream is, whatever it is, to have a dream, not to think about all this horrific stuff. The only reason I'm thinking about it is because it was put in my face. I'd like it removed so that we can have a decent life. That's my whole motivation here. Not to hurt anyone, but to make sure that we have a shot at a decent life. You know, I've had a lot of people, you know, that most of the people I've met online, I mean, nice people, you know, but a lot of them have, you know, unfortunately, and it's probably not their fault, but they've given up. You know, they just say, look, I'm a debt slave. I'm a wage slave. The system's rigged. I can't win. It just sucks. And I'm just going to keep on trudging on. And I feel so sorry when I hear that. A lot of people that look into all the conspiracies about the world, well, whatever you want to call them conspiracy, but they look underneath. They try to find why the world and how it ticks, what makes it work. And they find the answers and then they give up. You know, it's all a hoax. This world's a hoax. God's a hoax. This is a hoax. That's a hoax. There is no hope. We're just, you know, debt slaves, wage slaves. It's just a struggle. Then you die. Who cares? You know, and that's the sound of someone that's very depressed as well. Or they're saying, you got to get out of the matrix. You know, and I know plenty of people that rejected the Bible and God. And I understand that, you know. I don't reject people for rejecting the Bible and God. I absolutely think that's part of the process of God, you know, is rejecting, you know, I'm not saying join the Satanist and then be, you know, become a parasite. I'm just saying that I understand, you know, that it makes sense. It's like they're acculturated and indoctrinated by the church, the school, the institutions, and they reject it, of course. Well, I applaud that, actually, because you're not really rejecting God. You're rejecting the institutions. It's like a Operation Mindcrime by Queensryche. Remember that the big pinnacle of it is the guy rejects Jesus in the end. He's got this weird thing going with Mary, right? And then Mary, quite contrary. And then the big thing is, I don't need Jesus, never did, and never will. Now, I understand that they're rejecting religion, not Jesus, because they don't know what Jesus is. They're rejecting religion, which is why I never really objected to Operation Mindcrime. If someone said to me, you know that Operation Mindcrime, you like this Queensryche band? Well, back in the 80s I did. I don't really like them now, to be honest with you. But I did back then. I was, you know, playing tennis, listening to Queensryche, and I just was living in a little bubble, and it's really quite something back then. But listening to Queensryche while I was writing, I used to, you know, have a certain kind of songs I'd listen to while writing, and I even listen to that into the 90s when we had the whole grunge thing going and all that. But I, it was like, I don't need Jesus, never did and never will, is the big, you know, he's also rejecting the whole notion of this girl and the whole system, you know, and he's saying, I don't need religion and all the evil that goes with religion. It's a rejection of institutionalized religion. And you know, I just know that's what the lyrics mean, you know what I mean? Because to really reject Jesus, it's you have to know the whole story, including about religion. You have to really know a lot. And so I don't believe that the writers of this piece understood what they were saying, not as concise as it could have been, but, you know, it was effective. However, that being said, not giving anyone a pass here, you know, don't know. I mean, it's an anti-establishment piece is what it is. It's a rebellious piece. Now, if you're saying I reject Jesus and here's the devil horns flashing those and I'm going to Satan, then it's like your Jesus was Satan to begin with. So by rejecting Jesus and going to Satan, it's just one big circle jerk. It's one big ridiculous, you know, notion in somebody's head. Okay. Having said that, I went and saw, we went, it was kind of an unfortunate night. We went and saw the band Queens, they divided into two groups. One was the Jeff Tate band doing Operation Mindcrime, and the other one was Queensryche, who kicked Jeff Tate out. And so then they were suing, they wound up being the real Queensryche, and Jeff Tate became Operation Mindcrime. So we saw that, and yes, folks, I hate to, in Albuquerque, New Mexico, there were people just going there to the casino. You know, this was like in the big go room they were playing. And they were going there waiting for that I Don't Need Jesus. And the first thing, as soon as it got to that part, which you had like 45 minutes in, you know, it's like a big medley. These people, all of a sudden, up go the devil horns. They waited the whole time. I don't need Jesus yet. Now that is different. They are rejecting Jesus. And maybe he's rejecting Jesus too. Maybe they're all Satanists. I don't know. You know what I mean? I'm not going to give an ultimate pass. But the way I took it was, since it was dealing with institutions, and the character Mary represented the institution of the Catholic Church, I just thought, okay, that was my thought about it. You know, but again, I'm not that I recommend it. I certainly don't. I'm tired of that kind of music, but I'm not tired of it. I mean, it's okay, but I just, you know, when you hear something so many times, you just get to, you know, you get to, because I would listen to that when I was writing. I listened to early Dream Theater back then. I listened to all kinds of stuff, you know, that would help me to write. And sometimes I'd listen to that kind of music, and other times I would listen to... I had very, very diverse tastes, a lot of jazz fusion, you know, kind of, you know, I had just a lot of, you know, film scores and, you know, my taste in music is very diverse. It's not like someone said, well, here's some old rock and roll. I'm like, I can't think of anything more boring, but you play rock and roll. Yeah, but see, that's different, but I also do other stuff. I just can't be put in, you know, my listening tastes to kind of reflect my producing taste. I just have... You know, it just all depends, you know, but I like so many different things. And sometimes I like fancying something, but I haven't fancied anything in a long time, probably because I haven't had time. I guess the last thing was like the Book of Eli score by Atticus Ross and the Trent Reznor soundtrack of The Social Network from years ago that was inspiring to me. And what else? This guy, Paul Leonard Morgan, and his Judge Dredd electronic tracks. And I'm looking forward to one that was just recommended here. They're pushing him for an Academy Award on music. Oh, gosh. Cliff Martinez, right, that Steve was telling me about, that he just saw that movie, and that movie's out. But they're really pushing him for the Academy Award for best. I feel it. Yeah, I think Cliff Martinez is going to get it. I haven't heard the score yet, but I'm gonna get the score directly. But that's the kind of music I like. I will go out of my way for that. Usually a score would be a combination. You know, it might be a rock tune on there. For example, there was a cover, the best cover of a Led Zeppelin track I've ever heard in my life was the Immigrant Song. It was on the Social Network album, produced, I believe, by Trent Reznor. I can't prove that, but I think it was Reznor production. And that was the most amazing recreation of a song I think I've ever heard. And again, that did deserve to win, in my opinion. But even a better soundtrack was Atticus Ross's soundtrack of Broken City, which was a failed movie, but it was a brilliant bit of music. And of course, using a combination of electronic, you know, synthesizers, you know, real instruments, pianos, different things, and then having the electronic interface and all that. These guys are, so they inspire me, you know, but it's a very, not a lot of people. And I just think that one of the problems with music has been is with pop culture, and that's kind of why I tuned out of it, and why I like these other kind of more adventurous soundtracks and things, is because they're not supposed to be, you know, it's like there's this vibe isn't on it. You know, I almost feel there's like a control vibe on music to get me to think a certain way or be a certain way. Same with television shows. You know, I just feel, I'm suspect of all of them. You know, every once in a while there's a movie that's okay to go to. But then again, I'd rather watch it in my own little big screen so that I can reject it. You know what I mean? And so I could say, no, I'm not going to see that because I don't want to be, you know, dictated to. Okay, we've come to the end. I'm going to try to get myself together here. I just really went into... you have to know this. May I make one little complaint? It's not a complaint, but it's... I just want you to know, when I do one of these shows, and then, of course, I'm going to try to get myself in the studio. I'm working on something, and hopefully, I'm hoping Kelly can help me out with it. I really... You know, I'm exhausted. It's like an outpouring, you know. I'm not complaining. I'm just saying it's now Govinda would say this too. He's saying, I can't believe it. I said, yeah, it's they don't realize it, but it's you put a lot of energy into this thing because you're really trying, you're really needing to be sharp, so you're really concentrating, you're really putting everything into it that you can, sort of emptying yourself, if you will, of your ideas and your, you know, the things you're thinking about. But the bottom line on it all, I think this cannot be said enough. I just want a better world. And this is my contribution to it. I can't save the world, but I can make a small contribution. And I don't want people like me to commit suicide, you know, because it's misunderstood. Because it would be an accidental death. Because it wouldn't be, because it's the wrong paradigm. You know, that's their paradigm, not yours. So I want you all to be encouraged. I mean, wouldn't you rather be God's son, God's daughter, a son or daughter of the Most High, than one of them? I mean, I don't think it's really a question you have to struggle with. Are you willing then to put up with a little bit of that persecution that Jesus had? Because he guaranteed you'd have it too. And can we just... therefore, not kill ourselves because of, you know, stupid people, violent people, awful people out there who get coordinated and spiritual attacks on you, and it looks like it's gang stalking. It is, but it's organized in another dimension. And sometimes the very people themselves that you think are people turn out not to be the people you thought they were, but rather like a holographic projection. Then you see the real people again, and then they're not doing it at all. And you're wondering, what the hell kind of world am I in? Believe me, you're not abnormal. Your parents should have taught you that. Your older brother should have taught you that. Your churches should have taught you that. But they didn't. And so you're thrown in the deep end of the pool, not knowing what end is up. And they try to trick you into getting rid of your soul for protection. That's not fair. That's not fair. When you make a decision to give your soul away, if you're going to do that, such a stupid thing, then you really need all the facts. Otherwise, it's not really a free will decision, is it? So my theory is there's a lot of people who stupidly went that way, and they're just waiting for God to do something, or they're begging for help. Those are prodigal sons and daughters. Those are people we need to be praying for. And, you know, so you can't write people off ever really, you know, unless and until you understand that, okay, there's just a difference here that's, you know, it's like a physical thing. And then, yeah, you know, if you're arguing with a hologram, I mean, you know, there is that too to factor in. But then again, on the other hand, there's being fluid and not being, you can't be the judge, jury, and executioner ultimately. So you never really get into that position of authority. You're just really the servant. And you're there to you know, you get mad.
and you realize there is no there there with people that, not that you disagree with, but who are fundamentally, how shall I put it, anti-Christ, so they'd be anti-you. If you perceive as you go down, they go up, and as they go down, you go up, or something, you perceive that inverted relationship, then you understand what you're dealing with, right? There's plenty of that going on. If you're intact, that means the other guy is the parasite. You know, you make your own mind whether you want to have that parasite hang around. I made a decision to have my friend hang around, even though half the time he was, I mean, when he would stab me, at least he'd stab me in the front, but he was stabbing me. Then he'd be nice. He was back and forth. So the Lord had me ministering to him, but that's not something I could do every day, you know, because this war is about to ramp up, especially over this Christmas. And I just believe that they are going to do what they usually do, which is try somehow to malign you so they can get power. And they're going to go after these Pizzagate people so they can, they're trying to work that around to a big, let me tell you the prime mover in all this. The MSM, for example, they're mad that people aren't paying attention to them anymore. So they want to force you to pay attention to them, to be the arbiter. But when they come out and they say, without any proof, there's nothing to see here, move along, then they look like the Gestapo. You know, they look like the totalitarian. People turn off in droves. And they don't understand that what they're doing is turning people off even more. They're going against their own cause because they're not, they don't see it's a bigger spiritual battle. They don't see they're on the wrong side of history. They're on the wrong side of the spiritual battle. And so they're their own worst enemy. Everything they do just seems to be, nobody even has to do anything. You just watch the MSM self-implode of their own, you know, dumb reactions. The right reaction, of course, for any news media is, hey, there is no actionable evidence here. We have these emails that seem to be coded, seem to be talking pedophile stuff, and even worse. So we have a mandate here to investigate. It may not lead to anything. And that's, you know, if they wanted to be responsible, they could calm people down, because people are very upset and offended when if they think children are being harmed. It makes the MSM look like they don't care about children. They're so stupid in public relations, but I'm watching them. No one has to put them out of business. They're putting themselves out of business. The right approach would have been, and the reason they're doing that is because it's such a hot button issue, because people can go to jail. I mean, there's a lot of powerful people that their lives are at stake. So, you know, that they want to be able to work in the cover of darkness. So they tell the news media, who they own, by the way, you will provide darkness so I can keep existing in my dark world. And that's just, you know, they look like now child trafficking enablers. So there you go. But did anyone convict them? Did anyone accuse them of anything? No, no one accused them. They just did it on their own. And then they blame the you know, the 24-year-old researcher who feels that they got onto a story that the FBI and everybody else won't investigate, so they've taken it upon themselves to investigate. And there's this a group of kids, really, around the world who have compassion for children, who want to end human trafficking. And if, you know, society won't do its job, they will. So to me, these are heroes, these kids, you know? Just like heroes on the battlefield, you know, they're, and I'm just saying, I'm bringing awareness to the fact they're going to take some slings and arrows and persecution. And, you know, just like they tried to take this actor, they hired an actor to go in there and like shoot his gun off to show that, look, to associate that with all the people doing the research as being bad people. The other thing is the hotheads that are so-called researchers, a lot of them are agent provocateur. In other words, they're there to be hotheads, to kind of go online and troll and accuse people of pedophilia, accuse them of murdering children when there's no evidence, to discredit the whole situation, to get people to, and if they could get laws passed, they would do that. But see, the thing is, we're in the era of Trump now, and you know, it's just a very, very tempestuous, very unstable time. You know, anything could happen on any day. Because of the, because desperate people, you know, when people are cornered and they're desperate, they do desperate things. And if the news media fails to get the attention off of this, then they'll make more desperate measures, you know, war, terror, false flag terror. I mean,
there's anything you can imagine. So therefore, we as people in the world, you know, who are aware, must have a vigil and stay in prayer. And of course, not, you know, they're violent, but we're not violent. You know, we fight a different way. We fight with prayer. We fight in the spirit. And that's what I really want to encourage people to do. And also, you know, we can't just go accusing people. I mean, I know we've, you know, I'm going to have to shore it up a little bit too, because it gets right on the borderline of that. You know, when I say Soros is above the law, he's doing all this stuff with the rioting. Well, do I have 100% proof? Well, I do pretty much, but he still needs to be, you know, arrested or prosecuted and to have a jury and all that. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, we can't, you know, we got to put caution. I'm going to put caution on my own words and just say, hey, look, I'm not accusing anyone ultimately of anything. I mean, I'm accusing, but I'm not convicting, because that's up to a jury to do. Okay. And, but I've seen enough evidence with the busing in of people and all that to see that it was not organic and see that somebody was doing it. And we also have traces back to Soros' account. So we've got that. But it would still take someone arresting him, since that's really illegal, you know, to have riots and damage property and things. It's got to go back to the guy paying for it, right? So, yes, but we have to draw a line and say, okay, at the same time, arrested, yes. Convicted, no. He has to be convicted by gathering of evidence, just like everybody else. Are they going to tamper with that evidence and all that? Probably. Have they buried all the Pizzagate evidence? Probably. They've had plenty of time to do it. So, yeah, it's probably buried, totally. Are they blackmailing? Yeah, someone's probably got that evidence, and they're blackmailing each other right and left with it all. But here's the thing. You know, it's so, but like this guy that owns the pizza restaurant, they're making him into the sympathetic victim now that's been slimed and smeared and death threatened and all that. And there's no call for that at all. It's, well, for all I've seen is it seemed like he was implicated in this stuff, and that's it. He's a suspect. There isn't anything more to it than that. You know, he can't be convicted on what's there. But it looks awfully suspicious, and if so, he's a monster, okay? But we don't know. And that's just, so we just can't, you know, I mean, I would tell people, don't go yelling at people online or anything like that. Just quietly do your research. You know, the thing is that in the past, it's always been buried and successfully. We have today, we have the child trafficking now combined with the satanic panic. First time, you know, I think, no, it's actually the second time in recent memory, because we had Hampstead, which, by the way, that's they're reopening that again. The citizens are there. So that's now, you're seeing videos of that pop up. So it's really going. And I think, you know, the world's panicked, you know, and would they go to World War III nuclear to stop? Yeah, they could. If they're that kind of monster that you think they are, would they be capable of, false flag wars? To shut it down. Yeah. You know, so I think, you know, I kind of see what's going on, but like I say, I'm not a fervent on the edge researcher of this, because I'm looking also at Clinton Global Initiative. I'm looking at the election tampering. I'm looking at, you know, I'm keeping an eye on that, praying up a storm that they don't cheat. And then I'm seeing the evidence that they cheated all over the place, like Nevada and other places. It's just a struggle. You know, there's so many fronts of criminality. There's so many fronts of, you know, hurt the Americans, hurt the, you know, control them, get our own people in there, and then lord it over them. And, you know, and what I want to see, and my prime thing is, what I want to see, like I said before, I want to see people succeed. I'd love it if kids could grow up and be able to pursue a dream. Let's say it's music, let's say, or something in the theater, or, you know, whatever they want to do. And they have the freedom to do it without just being plagued with this sort of on again, off again life, where everything is just, you know, it's on hold one day. People are not getting sleep. There's evil everywhere trying to encroach, and the people doing it are not getting in trouble. And I just want to see people be able to, I mean, it looks like it. I see kids surfing, and they don't seem to be bothered by anything. You know, I see the rock stars are still out there stomping around the stage. They don't seem to be upset about anything, but I don't know. You know, maybe it's just me just being aware and realizing the dangers that, you know, maybe when I was younger, I wasn't so keen on understanding all that. But for my own survival, to not be bummed out and depressed, I had to understand. And I understand enough now to not take it personally, to not be depressed over it. I mean, I may be depressed, but that would just be a cycle I'm going through. I'm not going to let these people, you know, we've seen how monstrous they could be. Okay, fine. You know, fine. That was their choice. They signed on to that a long time ago, and it progressed to the point now where they're so sick, it's ridiculous. I just want to make sure that we have a fighting chance here. And I got faith that there's a lot of good people doing a lot of good things. And with that, folks, I'm going to let you go. I'm just looking for going to maybe play a couple of songs here on the way out. But I bid you shalom. I'm praying for you. Please pray for us here. And I just pray, Lord, in Jesus' name, that you guide us through this whole thing. And let those who are capable of having joy, let them have joy in Jesus' name. And I'll see you next time. Some of you have written me about the gang stalking thing, and you've done what Jeremiah did. You've cursed your mother's womb. You cursed the day of your birth. You wish you could die. You don't want to kill yourself, but every day is just another thing coming at you. And I'm just like, well, if you weren't really a great person, God would not challenge you like that. So obviously you could take it, and obviously you've done a great job with it. And, you know, from time to time, you break down and complain because you don't think anyone's noticing. But everyone's noticing you've done a great work here. Not everybody can go head-to-head with all this stuff. You know, the people that do go head-to-head with it have been obviously selected by the Lord for that special task. And the reward is great. So, but, yeah, when you're embattled with it, it seems like you're all alone. And it just seems like you're fighting in vain. And that's what the devil tries to do with your mind, to make you think it's all in vain. But no, you're being victorious. You know, if you didn't kill yourself, you're being victorious. If you kill yourself, then you failed. You know, you in the eyes of God, you lost. You know, you had the strength and everything to do it, but you got a little bit selfish. You got impetuous, and you paid with your life. You know, I understand that too.